Good evening, Director, staff, and members of the public. I will now call this January 10th, 2023 regular business meeting to order. We will first begin tonight by acknowledging that the buildings within Minneapolis Public Schools are located within the traditional homelands of the Dakota people. Minnesota comes from the Dakota name for this region, Minnesota Makoche, translating to the land where the waters reflect the skies or cloudy waters. MPS recognizes the original people of this place and is committed to making ongoing efforts to educate the community about the relationship that Dakota people have to this area, both historically and today as they remain here in their home. Thank you. Director Norville, will you please call the roll for the record?
Director Abdi. Yeah. Director Fiyari. Yeah. Director Cirillo. Present. Director Norville. Present. Director Jourdain. Here. Director Beachy.
Here.
Director Ellison.
Present.
Director Emmerich.
Here.
Chair Elamin.
Here. Thank you. We have a quorum. As Director Ellison mentioned last week, we're excited to welcome our student representatives soon, and we expect them to be seated next month. Thank you. Next, we will approve our agenda for the rest of the meeting. Director Beachy, will you please move approval for the agenda?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Our agenda has been moved and seconded. Is there any questions? I will move to amend the agenda and pull off consent agenda items 7A, 2A, the contract authorization with Axiom for separate consideration. Is there a second for the amendment?
Second.
It has been moved and seconded to pull item 7A, 2.A from the consent agenda. I have asked to pull this item so we can hear a little more information about it before voting. Is there any discussion on the motion to amend the agenda? Seeing no or no further discussion, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed say nay. The motion to amend the agenda carries. We are now back to the main motion of the approval of the agenda as amended. Is there any further discussion of the agenda as amended? Seeing no further discussion, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed say nay. That motion carries and the agenda as amended is adopted. Next, Director Norville, can I please get a motion to approve the minutes before us?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Approval of the minutes for the December 13th, 2022 meeting has been moved and seconded. Any discussion or corrections? Seeing no or no further discussion or correction, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed say nay. That motion carries and the minutes are approved. Next, we will hear from those who have signed up to provide comments here tonight. As staff projects the list and our first speaker comes to the podium, I remind us all of the public comment guidelines. Our goal here is to hear from those who have signed up in a fair, respectful way. To do this, we ask each commentator to begin by stating their name in relationship to Minneapolis Public School, to keep comments within the 2-minute limit or 4-minute if you are using an interpreter, not to mention identifiable information about individual staff members or a student, and not to use profanity, insults, or threats. If these guidelines cannot be followed, I will provide a warning, and then if needed, I will turn off the microphone and end your comment time. And finally, please remember that this is an opportunity for the board to hear from the community, so we will not respond in the moment to comments or questions. Staff may follow up or connect with you based on your comment. Director Norville, will you please call through the list of speakers?
Thank you, Madam Chair. Gary Marvin Davison.
Gary Marvin Davison, New Salem Educational Initiative, just a 12-minute walk from the Davis Center, serving students who come from a demographic that has been academically abused for at least four decades. I sent you an email today that embedded a letter, four-page letter, that gave you my thoughts on the superintendent process. We stand at a very important historical juncture precisely because you have the chance to make the best decision that a school board has ever made in terms of selecting a superintendent. You also, if you don't exercise good judgment, can make the biggest mistake that you have ever made. I attached to that email a document from A.J. Crable from the Council of Great City Schools from early October, in which he counseled the board that while he thought that a community engagement firm was probably a good idea, you did not necessarily need to do or need to hire a search firm for the superintendent. He said you could do that. You could also have an external law firm, but you should do it selectively. And he encouraged you to reach out to candidates. And very specifically, if you read that document carefully, he urged you to look first internally. You have a number of highly qualified internal candidates who know this district well and who are now serving under the brightest prospect that you could ever have in Rochelle Cox. Reach out to these internal candidates. Heed A.J. Crable's advice. The board brought him in to provide advice, but the summary of that advice has not been very clear. You have a chance to make history. There are lives in the balance, the students whom I love and serve in the community. You will see more kids die on the streets and go to prison if you continue to make the decision that other boards have made. Please make the right decision.
Thank you. Katie Kampoff.
Good evening, directors. My name is Katie Kampoff, and I'm a Henry Special Education and Inclusion teacher, MFT 59 Stewart, and District 1 resident. I took a look at the CDD slides for tonight's presentation and was rather taken aback by the information being presented to the board around the current status of the career and tech education centers at North, Roosevelt, and Edison. First, I had not realized the CTE centers fall under the equity category of the CDD. This surprised me because Henry High School is 92% racially isolated, a data point that was not projected to change from the CDD 2021 boundary changes. However, we were still told we would be losing our engineering, robotics, and communication programs in the fall of 2023. This means all of our teachers, curriculum, and resources will be leaving Henry High School this year and go to North this fall. Two of those three teachers we will be losing at Henry are beloved veteran Henry Black teachers who combined have been at Henry for almost 30 years. Has anyone spoken to the 40 teachers that are going to be affected by this move, how they feel, if they plan on even staying in the district? Did the board know that students will be responsible for their own morning transportation to the CTE centers and afternoon transportation home from the CTE center? This could easily result in over an hour daily commute on Metro Transit that keeps cutting bus lines around our city. This hour-long commute doesn't even account for their transportation to and from students' home schools in either the morning or afternoon CTE classes. Has the board spoken to affected students? Have you asked them if they plan on staying in MPS after these CTE programs and classes are moved from their home schools? Last week, I learned that only 21% of MPS high school students had completed the CTE online survey, and high school administrators were being told that funding for the fall would be tied to the survey completion rate. Two major voices have been left out of the creation and implementation of the CDD, educator and student voices. I ask that the board halt the implementation of the CTE portion of the CDD and meet with affected students and staff to gather feedback. I think you all will be surprised with the information, especially around retention, you will find. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Sophia Butler.
Hello, I am a student of Sophia Butler, and she has given me her time to speak here today. The arts program at South has faced challenges with all of the cuts that have been happening. We have fewer available classes and resources to help students get engaged with the arts. It's really unfortunate to me that South is losing pieces of the arts because it really is a drawing factor of the school. I remember one of the reasons that I chose South was because I saw my older brother performing in the ensembles. I was really impressed with it, and I wanted to go to a school where I could develop as a musician like that. And now with the restrictions on the program from the lack of funding and time, it's really hard to reach the same level of success in the program. Our school has been reduced to a smaller number of ensembles for both band and orchestra as a result of the cuts. We no longer have a beginning band, so if you've never played an instrument or you only have a little bit of experience, it's really hard to jump in and get started. Music isn't as accessible to as many students anymore, which is a real shame because getting a student engaged in the arts can improve their focus in other more STEM-related classes. And involvement in the arts or extracurriculars in general is shown to improve graduation rates. With the removal of funding, there have been far fewer opportunities for the arts programs, and the number of incoming students and support for this program is declining. Our school had a tradition of hosting a swing night each year where all of the performing arts would collaborate to make a fun program meant for the entire community to enjoy. But with our limited resources, we've had to cut the event this year, which I know has disappointed a lot of students. Some students have seen what's happening and have dropped the arts completely because it's too difficult to stay engaged with a program that's not able to support all of its students completely. And we have less staff in the arts now, which means that remaining staff are super overwhelmed. Miss Butler, who taught orchestra and could afford to spend her time thinking about developing the orchestra program, now also has to think about the band program and the jazz program all at the same time. And it's a lot of unreasonable stress to be putting on the staff. So what this district needs is a full support of a wide variety of arts and abilities. Thank you.
Thank you. Christy Main.
Hi, everyone. I am here today to talk about school libraries. I'm a teacher at South High, and I'm a taxpayer in Minneapolis. So I today would like to inform you and the school board members about the library programming in Minneapolis Public Schools. Historically, Minneapolis has had a robust library program until 2013, when the cuts to the librarians began. And today, the majority of our sites do not have librarians. Those cuts have had a direct impact on the literacy, equity, and sustainability goals of this school board. Last month, I spoke to the library standards of students and teachers that are currently not being taught in the majority of our sites. The gaps that we have in a student's education from site to site have a direct impact on our ability to educate our students equitably. Libraries have a proven track record of supporting literacy, equity, and sustainability. I ask that the school board fully embrace the common set of characteristics of a highly effective school library program from the American Association of School Libraries, some of which include a state-certified full-time library media specialist in the building, the availability of a paraprofessional staff who undertakes administrative tasks and frees the librarian to manage reading literacy initiatives, an active instructional program of literacy and information, and a school library that meets the funding of 15 to 20 books per student at a $21 allocation per student. As you consider the goals of Minneapolis, I would like you to guarantee predictable staffing of librarians to ensure that students' access to library standards, literacy programming, which includes access to books every day. Or in other words, fund teachers who teach standards first before anything else. Thank you.
Thank you. Katina Taylor.
All right, good evening. Hello, board, superintendent, and all watching. My name is Katina Taylor, and I'm the president of the ESP chapter for MFT 59. I'm here tonight to talk about two issues that have deeply impacted the ESPs in this district and have burdened union and district resources. The first is significant errors with our sick and vacation accruals. There are many non-duty days throughout the school year. unlike salaried employees who have their pay spread out to cover non-duty days, ESPs must use vacation on these days in order to receive a full paycheck. And of course, ESPs must use sick time when they are sick for the day. And when they are on medical leave for the birth of their baby or to take care of a sick parent. This year, many ESPs discovered that their accrual balances were off. They weren't accruing at the appropriate rate, or they weren't accruing at all. The second issue is related to an MOA that was negotiated last round, giving ESPs an additional 5 hours per week. That was meant to be part of their regular assignment. The rollout and implementation of the MOA was confusing, harmful, and nothing short of disastrous. Some ESPs were entitled to the 5 hours. They were never offered the additional time, or they were offered the time weeks or months after the start of the year. There is also an issue with using sick and vacation time for additional hours, which would take too much time to explain right now, but resulted in ESPs not being able to enter that sick and vacation time for their full assignment when needed. But most important is that some ESPs were asked to demote by 5 hours a week in order to get the 5 hours a week. This nullified the benefit MOA and will leave these ESPs with less hours next year than they had last year. I thought it was important to share this with you all, but
please
also
finish your comment.
To let you know that district employees have been working hard and partnering with us to resolve the accrual issues and ensuring everyone who is entitled to the additional 5 hours are receiving it. And I sincerely hope they will continue to collaborate with us and ensure that no one is left harmed moving into next year. In closing, I'd like to ask you all to consider having school board members on the district's bargaining team for the upcoming round of negotiations so you can participate in the most important conversations that happen at the table and learn more about our contract. Thank you so very much.
Thank you. Jennifer Davis. Is Jennifer Davis here? Sal Shelton.
So I get 4 minutes? Hi. Thank you for listening to what I have to say. I am 35 years a social worker in this district. I've been in many buildings the last 23 years in early childhood special ed. And I want to say to you that what's important is that we are one family. We are one group that is MPS. I have the honor of working under a wonderful administrator right now. And before that, a true gem. I have had admins who have not had my back. I had one who told me not to tell the students the truth because it might hurt their feelings. And I said, nope, I am telling them the truth. And then I'm going to stand with them to deal with those feelings and deal with what might come next. I don't believe that special education is an appropriate title because I think every education needs to be specialized for all of our students. I do think that those of us in quote unquote special education add the comprehensive education to all of our students. I do believe that. And so in closing, I want you to honor what our latest contract said, and that is that there would be a lane change for those of us who have certain licenses, including certain social workers, who add that comprehensive education for all of our students. You've asked us.
Please finish your comment.
I will. You've asked us to back our students no matter what. Please back our staff no matter what. Thank you.
Thank you. Shannon Fagerstrom.
Good evening. My name is Shannon Fagerstrom. I'm a school social worker, and I work just up the hill here from the Davis Center over at Mona Modi Early Learning Center. Mona Modi is the only building in the district focused solely on the needs of our youngest learners and has been providing preschool since 2005. Our program has grown to provide preschool to 80 students in North Minneapolis. Mona is a thriving, energetic school filled with joy and laughter of 3-, 4-, and 5-year-olds. Currently, our enrollment is at 91%. Our team is a wealth of early childhood knowledge and experience for the district, and early childhood is our passion. With exceptional leadership of our director, Elizabeth Fields, our building and program is designed with our youngest learners always at the center, always guiding our work and our principles. Mona is a model of what holistic and culturally responsive early childhood classrooms should look like across the district. And I'm here today because our team received the sad news that district leadership will be submitting, or already have, a letter to the board to close our program next school year. They're not closing us due to saving money or due to low enrollment. They're closing us to try to move our 80 students to other schools in hopes to retain higher enrollment for kindergarten. Our school's not discrepant from other neighboring schools regarding the lack of retention for kindergarten, retaining only about half. The early childhood funding that MPS receives from the state of Minnesota is about providing exceptional early childhood education to preschool children. This is exactly what we do, and we do it well. Our team invites you to meet with us, to come and visit us, to come and see our gem of a preschool before you decide our fate, before you take away a program that's excelling in North Minneapolis. And I have a handout if it's okay to approach.
Yes.
Thank you. Felicia Minor.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Felicia Minor. I am an AE at Mona Modi up the street. I've been there for 9 years, and the program has been going very well from what I see. The children that come in, they need this head start to get on with life. So we teach them color-shaped numbers. Some of them come in, they can't hold a pencil. But when they leave our program, they can hold a pencil, write their name, know stuff that kids their age should know. So we're asking not to have the program closed out. Come down and see what we do. And once you see it, then you'll be excited, just as excited as we are, as the staff that's there at Mona Modi. Mona Modi, we're there for our community, the kids, the parents. And again, like I said, once you come there, you will be just as excited as we are. So I hope, if not all of you, some of you can come down and see how the program is ran before we're closed down and our kids is moved somewhere else. So, sorry. Thank you.
Thank you. Dawn Bancom.
Good evening. have to put these on because I can't see nothing anymore without them. Age. Hi, my name is Dawn Bankin, and I'm an early childhood special ed teacher that supports students at Mona, Modi this year, Loring, and Hmong International. I've had the honor to be part of two thriving programs. At Hmong International, when Karen and I, LeMay, started, she's here for me tonight, our 14th year co-teaching the Inclusion High Five. In the first 8 years, we had the privilege of working with Donna Harris and Deborah Gook-Vaxson with the Early Childhood Special Ed Fraser Mental Health Program. And we created a program over there where we back and forth mainstreamed. I added students to my caseload that we knew were gonna come to the Inclusion High Five the following school year, so they wouldn't have to give up staff to send that student to get my, you know, acclimated to the High Five room. We heard from district leadership how well of a program that was, and then all of a sudden space became an issue and that was no longer considered a model program, and the district moved them over to Hull. That was a very sad day for us at Hmong. For the last 2.5 years, I've had the privilege of working at Mona Modi with a fabulous team that I can't tell you, walk in their rooms and it's like magic. We work well as a team to really promote not over-identifying our students, and we create a program that caters to all students, meeting the behaviors where they're at, and increasing or creating a program and environment that we can meet the needs of all students. It is a thriving Northside program, and it is the only program in Minneapolis that is only geared towards early childhood students. And it's another opportunity that's gonna possibly be taken away for parents to choose from. There's families that start out in the early childhood program, family ed, move to three school, and then have the opportunity to stay in the same building for High Five. And I really hope, like other people have spoken to, that you take the time to come see our program before you strip it away. Thank you.
Thank you. Cassie Gutenfelder.
Hello there. My name's Cassie Gutenfelder, and I'm the three school teacher at Mona Modi. I'm speaking on behalf of the teachers at our school. Mona is a magical place for children and families, and it's unique in its role within the Minneapolis Public Schools, as others have said. The program is designed to meet the needs of young children from 0 to 5 years old in this very vulnerable and important time of their lives, particularly after the disruption of the pandemic. Mona is the only place with an MPS that supports families from a child's birth and continues that support until kindergarten, helping our youngest learners grow and learn from day one and serving as a natural extended family for young parents. The experience begins with education classes for parents, ECFE, bridging into the three school experience and then on to High Five, all inside the same building, a building that was designed specifically for our youngest learners. The support that families receive is essential and nourishing, building a community at a time in young families' lives when they need it the most. Families throughout the North Side feel supported and see the difference a play-based, developmentally appropriate program can make in their children's lives. Many families purposefully seek out Mona for this attention to each child and the joy that children feel when they learn to explore, experiment, and play collaboratively with their classmates. Because of this unique and purposeful environment, we have legacy families that entrust us with 2, 3, even 4 of their children. We even have parents who attended North Star School and tell us they remember being in the space and specifically wanted their child to have that same positive experience. This joyful learning space that has been built at Mona Modi cannot be replicated at another school. And taking away the program will not lead to retention of MPS students, but instead will fracture this community that has been built over so many years with love and care. Please keep our beloved school intact for the young children and families on the North Side. Thank you.
Thank you. Nikki O'Neill.
Nikki allowed me to speak. Mona Modi is a great school and a wonderful place. I remember when I was a little kid and being super excited to see all of the teachers and staff. And the way they worked there with everyone made going there even better. All the staff are so nice to everybody. That's why closing down Mona Mode would be tragic, especially when there are families waiting to go there. The same staff have remained there for over 6+ years, that's since I went there. Thank you for listening, and I hope you consider keeping Mona Mode open.
Thank you. Valerie Matthews.
Good evening. My name is Valerie Matthews. I'm one of the teachers at Mona Mode, parent educator with ECFE. I remember the day when we were told to move into Mona Mode. With our early childhood program, we went in, we were excited. We've grown that program into 3s now and 4-year-olds and 5-year-olds. And just recently we learned that the program will be closing come next year, next school year, no more 3s and 4-year-old programming. It is very sad. I'm so saddened. It's heartfelt at this moment to know the program will be gone from Mona. This is the best thing that ever happened to our BIPOC students and families on the north side. The best thing, as it relates to education, we know the value when we invest in early childhood. And that's what we do best at Mona. When these babies come, some of them come in pull-ups, and we get them trained, ready to step into kindergarten. When families walk in, they know they're coming to a second home where their children are at. Parents love to walk into Mona Mode because they feel very, very, very accepted and respected because the teachers, we all make them feel that way. Not everyone walks into a Minneapolis public school and feel welcome. Our families do. And I'm here on behalf of all those families over the many years who attended and are still attending Mona Mode Early Learning Center. I'm here standing for them and for their children to know if you take away Mona Mode, you're taking away children's opportunity to be successful, not just in kindergarten, but in life. And I urge you, please, please take a walk up the hill and see what we're talking about. Thank you.
Thank you. Brianna Thompson.
Good evening. My name is Brianna Thompson. I am a parent of 2 thriving babies that go to Mona Mode right up the street. And I say thriving, they are doing amazing. That place is magical. I love it. In fact, I loved it so much, I even became a staff there for a little while. I'm actually a homeowner in the community as well, just a few blocks down the street. And I want to talk about if Mona Mode gets closed down, it's going to be horrible for the community. This community does not need any more losses at all. I've took many classes on how children learn the most from birth to 5 years old. They learn the most out their whole life during those short 5 years. And that's what Mona Mode specializes in. So if we take that away from our community, what is that gonna do? I have 2 babies that go there. One is gonna go off to kindergarten next year and one is gonna be in high five. And I planned on sending my baby there because that's where she feels loved, supported. She's advanced so much. And when I heard the news, my heart just broke. And if Mona Mode gets closed down, I want you guys to know that it's just not a school getting closed down. It's kids' safe havens that's gonna be taken away from them. It's meals, it's love, it's structure, it's friendships. So it's bigger than just the school. So like everyone else said, if you guys can walk up the road and check it out, spend a few hours there and see the magic that happens in that place, that'll be wonderful because we can't let that school close down. It's the only place in Minneapolis that is designed to have early childhood education services in 3 school and high five. And I know a lot of people say that kids can go to other schools in the community. They can't because there's no other schools like that in the community. And as a parent, I'm not gonna feel comfortable sending my three-year-old to a school with fourth, fifth, and sixth graders. I'm not gonna feel comfortable. Not every kid is prepared to be in environments with older kids. So like I said, I'm gonna leave here with this. Why take something away from the community that's working? It's thriving. Why take that away? So like they said, come check it out. It's amazing.
Thank you. Venus Brown.
Hello, my name is Venus Brown. I'm a parent at Modi Modi, and I've been a parent over 10 years. I had three boys that went through Modi Modi that had high view behavior and issues, but going to Modi Modi had turned them around. I have relationships with them. It's just not Modi Modi. They do the early childhood outside classes that you can go to the early childhood classes to help you with behaviors or the different support that you need. So they give you extra support. And I think it would be a tragedy to close the school because this school is there for at least a lot of 0 to 5. And it's not just because my three boys went there, I have three of my grandkids there now. And I have two year olds, I was planning them to go when they get three. So that's how much I love this program. And I feel that this program is good. Like I said, I am a foster parent. And I was taught and trained that from 0 to 5 is a worst tragic part of a child to learn and be educated. And I think Modi Modi is that. So I had a grandson that had a problem with his bladder and his potty training. Now he's fully potty trained because for just going to Modi Modi. So I feel Modi Modi is a very good program. It's very educational and they support you in every way. And the staffs are very sweet and you build relationships. Like I said, you go in that place, it's magical, and the kids love it. My grandkids, like, I can't wait to go to school. So they love it. My other kids are, what, they 10 and 11 years old? They love it. Now my grandkids love it. And I was planning for my other two grandkids to go following years. But I pray that y'all do not close it. I need to go in there and see how much love and support and how much these kids really enjoy this program. Thank you.
Thank you. Becca Voss.
Hello, my name is Becca Voss, and I'm an AE at Mona Modi, as well as an MPS parent of a Washburn graduate. Thank you for this opportunity to share my experience at Mona. I came to Mona as a Minnesota Reading Corps member after 2 years with MRC at an early childhood program outside of the district. It was clear to me from early days that this program is special. Despite the fact that we were entirely virtual at the beginning of that first year for me, when we were able to return to the classroom for the last few months, we had a strong connection with our students who showed a joy of learning, exploring, playing, and discovery. The positive culture was no accident. It was created by the teacher's hard work and skillful delivery of early childhood methods. I felt so fortunate to be a part of that team, and I was inspired to shift the work that I was doing. I left for summer break energized and excited by the community at Mona and determined to become a part of the Mona team. I started the following year at another MPS school, but when a position opened up in the three-school classroom at Mona, I jumped at the opportunity. Mona Modi is not just a physical building with classrooms. Mona is successful because its educators and staff deeply love and care about their students and families. These teachers view early childhood education as an art and a craft, one that is backed by research and data, which they know well. I have found real joy this year watching the children do their work as three-year-olds, exploring, sharing, waiting, caring, helping, and expressing themselves along their learning path. The teachers at Mona Modi are skilled at creating a space for children where they feel supported, safe, and loved. All important elements to becoming not only a student for the next 15 years, but a lifelong learner. We may be a small program, but we are mighty, and the impact that we have on the North community is significant. MPS would be making a big mistake in closing this important community resource in North Minneapolis.
Thank you.
Thank you. Kulia Pringle.
Good evening, Board Interim Superintendent. My name is Kulia Pringle, and I'm the Minnesota State Director for the National Parents Union, and we represent many families within Minneapolis Public Schools. Tonight, I wanted to do something different than I normally do. Although there's a lot of work to be done within Minneapolis Public Schools, I wanted to take the time to shout out, or where I'm from, we say big up, to some of the individuals that are doing some great work, and my list is not exclusive, or it's not all inclusive, because there are principals, assistant principals, social workers, and support staff who are doing amazing work within Minneapolis Public Schools. So first, I'd like to shout out Director Cedillo and Director Alameen for your tireless and hard work, your leadership when it comes to Black and Brown children, all children, but particularly those that you represent. To Interim Superintendent, since you've been here, it's been a breath of fresh air. I've seen so many changes. The elevation of Black leadership in the district is such a beautiful sight. To Maria and Dr. Farron, the work that they're doing on within literacy, again, there's a lot of work to do, but the movement that they're making on literacy, literacy within MPS is amazing. To Dr. Harris Berry, who's not here, who took the time in the summertime to sit on the porch to meet with 11 Latine families. It was a hot day, and she sat on the porch and she met with those families to hear their concerns. To Tyree Cox and Tiki Blackmore for their leadership and making sure that Black children and Black families have a voice within Minneapolis Public Schools. To Associate Superintendent Yusuf Abdullah and Michael Walker, they have been so gracious in extending their support and making sure that there's somebody from the district in the spaces with parents as they're meeting with leadership within students, within schools, to make sure that parents feel like their voices are heard. Thank you.
Thank you. Lorelei Soley.
Hi, I'm Lorelei Soley. I have been a high school teacher for 10 years and have worked in Minneapolis for 5. The last 3 years, I've been an AVID elective teacher. AVID is a nationally recognized elective class for college-motivated students who fit one of the following 4 criteria. They are first in their family to attend college. They identify as a member of a racial or ethnic group that is underrepresented in college campuses. They qualify for free or reduced lunch or any other special circumstances unique to that student. During the 4 years of high school, AVID cohorts spend time developing skills that you need to be successful in high school and beyond. We learned about FAFSA, GPA, ACT, how to choose a college, how to write a resume, note-taking skills, and many more. Ideally, each cohort stays together all 4 years with the same teacher. And this way, I can personally advise my cohort what is the best move for them with, I know, their strengths, their goals, and them as a person. And this supportive community that they build over the 4 years together is unmatched to any affinity group I've ever seen in a high school. The CDD has had radical changes at the demographic makeup, specifically at Southwest High School. And this, in turn, seriously impacted our AVID program, decreasing our sections from 8 to 4. And AVID is directly tied to addressing issues of equity in a school community. The students talk about this being the class they feel most comfortable in during the day. And it offers so much opportunity knowledge for them that they may not have easy access to, and skills. So now that that group has gotten so much smaller at Southwest, we have to be very careful to support them. So in closing, I hope you think of AVID often as you make decisions for the district, and I invite you to come meet our students, talk to them, listen to them, hear their stories. Reach out anytime. Thank you.
Thank you. Sean Casey.
Good evening. I am following up on what Christy Main, the library media specialist at South High School, said earlier this evening. I am Also in library media, I am one of the two newly created itinerant library media specialists working with the teaching and learning department. And together, my partner and I are serving 10 different elementary schools that otherwise the students at these 10 schools would not be receiving any direct instruction or library access from a library media specialist. And that's just one example of the sort of inequities that Christy mentioned earlier. Prior to my serving in this role, in my previous 12 years in MPS, has been mostly at the middle school level. Of our 8 middle schools, only 3 currently have a library media specialist. And even among those 3 schools, students who attend them receive wildly different experiences. At one school, the media specialist does not teach classes, but allows students access to the library and teaches them library skills. At the other, it's the exact opposite situation. The library media specialist has a full teaching schedule and has very little time to manage the library and allow students access to it. The same situation exists at our K-8 schools. At one, there is no library media specialist. At the other, there is, but that staff member has been asked to do other things, such as manage devices or be testing coordinator. As a result, because students only interact with her in those capacities, she says many of them don't even know that she's their school librarian, and they just refer to her as the device lady. The result of this is that we have MPS students who can go through K-8 without ever receiving direct instruction from a library media specialist. By the time they get to high school is their first interaction with one, and at that point, we only have one library media specialist serving 1,000 or more students. So I echo what Christy said earlier to please make library media specialists a part of the predictable staffing model so that students have access all the way from K-12. Thank you.
Thank you. Becca Andreasen.
Hi, good evening. My name is Becca Andreasen, and I'm a Mona Modi parent. My preschooler is the most precocious child I've ever met. At 3.5, they have a grasp of language that rivals many kindergartners, and their acrobatic skill is greater than mine was at any age. We put them in 3 school into Cassie and Becca's class because they begged us to go to school. They love Mona Modi, the classroom, kitchen, the art on the walls, the garden where they grow tomatoes. We love the dedicated building, the small student body that allows students to each have individual attention, to be known by staff at the school. The staff are all completely focused on small children, on social emotional education, which is the real work of that age. They are responsive to each child and to where they are developmentally. And the whole school, the design of the building, the design of the classrooms, the way the staff operate, is based around the understanding that children not only learn best through play, but that they must learn through play. The ECFE through High Five model provides stability for children in the Jordan neighborhood, a majority BIPOC neighborhood where kids too often don't have much other stability in their lives. Mona Modi is a place of love and safety for them. It is a safe and loving space for me and my queer family who do not find safety everywhere. It seems to me that if we want to improve education and lives of our students, we would put a building like Mona Modi in every neighborhood in Minneapolis. As I understand it, the district is concerned about the number of students who go on to charter schools or schools outside of the district for elementary. We should be improving our elementary schools to serve students as well as Mona Modi does. Give them funding, give them teachers, give them flexibility to respond to students' individual needs. Our neighborhood elementary school, Hmong International Academy, had a first grade class with 30 students for the first 2 months of this school year, with my child in it. And I know how hard Principal Gao lobbied to be assigned another teacher. As long as things like this happen.
Please finish your comment.
Families will be motivated to choose schools outside of the district instead of being able to choose the close school in our neighborhood where the teachers, in all of their love, do not have the resources that Mona Modi has currently to do what the students need. Thank you.
Thank you. Stacy Gurian Sherman.
Hi,
Good evening. My name is Stacy Gurian-Sherman. I was a child care assistant with Minneapolis Kids for 5 years until the end of last October, when I reached a settlement agreement with the district to sever my employment for financial compensation that was equivalent to 2 years worth of my W-2 wages in exchange for not bringing legal claims against the district, including whistleblowing. I was also a member of the board and bargaining team for educational support professionals, ESPs, including during the last contract that was negotiated during the strike. I am here as a private citizen in solidarity with my family, my friends, my neighbors, and former colleagues who are exceptional educators, fully believing in what Nelson Mandela said. Education is the most powerful weapon you can use to change the world. I fully understand and intend to respect the non-disparagement clause in my settlement agreement, which prohibits me from disparaging the district and the district from disparaging me. During the time I was employed, I'm focused on the present and the future. And to that end, I have filed data requests and will continue to do so. My 2 minutes doesn't allow me to go into all of them, so I'm going to tell you about the one I filed about the ADA coordinator. The Federal Americans with Disability Act requires this school district to have an ADA coordinator. There isn't one. And right now, we have not had one for quite a while. Medical and medical health information is private and confidential, whether it's about maternity leave or accommodations for neurodivergent individuals or from surgery. According to the ADA director for the Minnesota Council on Disability, any information on accommodations on disabilities is a need-to-know basis. Just please let me finish my one thought. Right now, people who are applying for any kind of a temporary or permanent accommodations have to send private and confidential information to a generic email to someone they don't know is trained or qualified, and hand over that personal information. That is not right. That is not following the law. With a new school board and a new school year, I look forward to more progress and new ideas for every student, family member, and staff. I'll be back.
Thank you. Jade Macy Albers.
Hello, my name is Jade Mazier Albers, and I'm a sophomore at South High. At South, the arts provide a huge impact to many students, including myself. I have been involved in the dance program since last year, and it has impacted me in such great ways. Between the friendships I've made and the education I've received, the arts and the dance program at South have made my high school experience so much more fun and meaningful. Starting this school year, 40% of the dance program's budget has been cut, leaving only 3 periods of dance instead of 5. Fewer dance classes means that fewer students can take the class. There were high numbers of students who signed up for dance this year, but only around half were admitted due to budget cuts made by the district. There was also an entire band position cut, leaving both band and orchestra classes to be taught by only one teacher. South High's art programs provide a unique and special outlet for myself and so many other students. Being a part of dance has given me a chance to express myself and learn about other cultures. Our performances reflect the diversity of our school and our program. Students in the past have shared dances for Dia de los Muertos, East and West African dances, and indigenous dances. This has helped me educate myself about the cultures of my peers. Due to the budget cuts, fewer of these performances are able to happen. In the 11 years of South High Dance, an event called Swing Night has been a highlight of the year. Unfortunately, this event cannot happen this year due to fewer dance classes along with cuts to the band program. This is why we need to have all arts programs fully restored in the Minneapolis Public Schools district. Dance and the arts are essential to any school's curriculum and provide a safe space for students. They help us find our common humanity and come together as a community. We have a dance performance coming up on January 26th at 7 p.m. at South High, and everyone is welcome to attend. I have a flyer I'd like to give to the board. Please pass around. Thank you.
Thank you. Mustafa Duryea.
Good evening, everybody. I think I'm the last one, so I don't think I need time. I'm just kidding, I'm just joking. That's okay, good. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. The new directors, all of you. Good evening, my name is Mustafa. I am a community organizer and a family advocate. This is my eighth year that I'm coming here yelling all the, every day and go home with a headache. So each year at the beginning, I'm really excited. And the opportunities, new step, and the end of that year, I get disappointment. So hopefully this is a new beginning, okay? 8 years, so many faces has been changed. Congratulations, the new directors. And those of you who are already there. Couple things, and I wanna talk about a little bit the superintendent research committee, community listening sessions. I look at the list, and then I did not see Brian Coyle, see the Riverside area, and that tricked me a little bit. So I wanna, listening session, it should be added in where some of my community members are there. So we need added that to the list. And I think it's very important that families to hear and to listen and updated what is going on. So that's one thing I will request. Please add it if it's on other sessions or not. But so far, it's not there. So I hope they will add it. Because if you guys need, community should listen and what's going on and be updated. And that's one thing. And the other thing I wanna say is that there's a lot of opportunities for the district to rewrite the history. I connect a lot of families who already left the district, but they wanna come back to the district. So there is opportunity for the district to fix this issue. And there is
please
a lot
finish
of-
finish your comment.
Yes, so, and I wanna say thank you and welcome and congratulations to your team. I'm looking forward to talk to you and get to know you more. And that's it, actually. I just wanted here to say that for, so hopefully we have a good discussion coming. Thank you.
Is Jennifer Davis here? Last call for Jennifer Davis.
Thank you again to everyone who took the time to share your feedback and perspectives with us. We will now take a 10-minute recess. Directors, we will reconvene at 6:40. Thank you. I will now call this meeting back to order and turn it over to Interim Superintendent Cox to provide the superintendent report, including an update on the comprehensive district design. Directors, we will take questions after Interim Superintendent Cox comments and the CDD presentation. Please go ahead, Interim Superintendent Cox.
Thank you, Chair Lamine, and good evening, directors, staff, and those of us joining us here and online. I'd like to begin by congratulating the 2023 officers and by welcoming the new board members to your first business meeting. I really look forward to serving you all as your interim superintendent and working together on behalf of our community, our staff, and our students, and our families. Before I move into the main part of my report this evening, which will be an update on the comprehensive district design, I want to highlight a few items. First, the School Finder Fair was this past Saturday, and what a wonderful time we had with over 500 families and children who joined our staff from MPS at Minneapolis College to find a great school for their students. This event was actually hosted by the Great Minnesota Schools, and all Minneapolis schools, MPS, charter, and private, were invited. The fair provided a great chance for us to talk directly with prospective families and be available for their questions about our schools, programs, and our enrollment process. As many of you know, MPS has not held or participated in a citywide fair like this for some years, and we're looking at this as an opportunity to determine if citywide school fairs should continue, barring a pandemic, of course. We know that more than 40 students enrolled in MPS schools on Saturday, and we're also going to review and debrief about what worked for families and staff and what can be done better at future events. I want to personally thank the families who joined us, the over 200 MPS colleagues who staffed the tables, and to the communications, engagement, and enrollment staff who worked so hard to put this together. The fair came at the end of what was a very long week of winter weather, which turns out was one of the largest multiple days of snowfalls in a very long time. While I recognize the decisions we make regarding inclement weather will never meet the needs of everyone involved, please do know that our team works around the clock to survey road conditions, watch weather predictions, and most importantly, ensures we can safely run our schools and transportation systems, even if they're delayed. While e-learning is a helpful tool that allows us both to meet state instructional minimums and maintain a number of other calendar priorities, I know it's not the right fit for every student, and we view it as the last resort when we just cannot hold in-person school. As a native Minnesotan, I certainly agree with the many emails I received that snow days do have a certain magic. As interim superintendent, e-learning days do offer the opportunity for those who want instruction, and they do help prevent makeup days, which might need to occur during another cherished season in our state, summer. We will continue to work with our schools and staff about ensuring that e-learning can best meet the needs of our students and families, and we hope that we don't need to use them again anytime school. But we do live in Minnesota, after all. Finally on this, parents and caregivers always have the right to make the best or a different decision for their child. That may mean keeping them home if we hold school during bad weather, or not having your child participate in e-learning. In either of these cases, make sure to follow your school's attendance procedures if you need to make a different decision for your child. Next, I do want to public acknowledge the staff from Mona Modi who came here to speak during public comment. We recognize that any change which impacts our work will be challenging, in this case, the movement of some early childhood classrooms to elementary schools. My leadership team is eager to hear from them and their experience to ensure that these types of programming decisions are in the best interest of our students and family. Senior Officer Dr. Fearing and her team will work to arrange a meeting, which I believe will be happening tomorrow with the team. So we thank them for being here today, and we look forward to learning from them as we make this transition. Now, with the chair's permission, I'll move into the CDD update, which, as you can see from the number and detailed of slides, is part of the continuing commitment as interim superintendent to provide a transparent and thorough inventory of where things are with MPS, so that this new board, along with your new leader, have the foundation of information to make the needed changes to best serve our community. We will continue this work, beginning with next week's Finance Committee, as we start to outline the steps needed to better deliver on our vision, mission, and goals in our strategic plan, but both now and in the long term by ensuring a path to sustainability. But tonight, I want to take some time to walk both board members and our community through a status update on the different components of the comprehensive district design, better known as the CDD, which has moved from a design and is now the structure of how our district is organized. From 2018 to 2020, MPS worked to restructure the way we do business to address community concerns related to academic performance, equitable access to education, as well as the financial sustainability of our 150-year-old school district. That work was known as the Comprehensive District Design, or more often called the CDD. After extensive community engagement, MPS was at the point of board approval in early 2020, just when schools moved to distance learning due to the COVID-19 pandemic. Nevertheless, the MPS board approved implementation of the CDD in April 2020. Then, in early 2021, the Board of Education approved the MPS 5-year strategic plan that was built on the foundation laid out by the CDD. Implementation of the CDD has not, as you can imagine, proceeded at the pace we initially intended. However, much has been accomplished, and I want to summarize some of the progress tonight. No matter what you thought you knew or believed about the CDD, I hope to make one thing clear. The CDD is about much more than boundary changes. Tonight's presentation is a snapshot of where we are with the CDD. I look forward to presenting to you again in February and March for discussions about what's worked, what needs improvement, and how we move forward to achieve the initial goals of the CDD and ultimately the goals of our MPS strategic plan. The CDD was designed to ensure a well-rounded or holistic education for every student. For too long, MPS has tried limited reforms that have created pockets of success, but have failed to make a dent in decades-long achievement, access, and opportunity gaps that have remained predictable by race, income, and zip code. The CDD was created to disrupt the status quo with changes from policies to our curriculum, from our staff professional development to how we allocate our resources, from our grade configurations to our programming and staffing. We wanted to create the conditions for every single student in MPS to achieve their highest potential. That's academically, socially, and emotionally, and to be prepared for success in college and career for every student to receive a well-rounded education. The comprehensive district design has three focus areas: academics, equity, and sustainability. The foundation of our academic plan is our commitment of offering a well-rounded education to every student in the city. We believe that every student will graduate with the skills needed to be successful and aligned to their interest. They will be kind and caring adults that have a love for learning and a care for their community. Our students will have access to culturally relevant programming that builds a sense of pride and self-confidence in who they are as individuals and their ability to listen and learn with diverse communities. Having various opportunities to pursue their interest, that students and adults will feel valued for who they are and the perspective they have, and they'll have a sense of belonging and feeling seen and heard. They will feel safe. They will not need to leave their neighborhood in pursuit of an excellent education. And there will be more opportunities for students to learn from students and teachers of different languages and backgrounds. In terms of equity, we will reduce the number of schools that are isolated by race and income. We decided we would do this by modifying policies, regulations, and placement of programs that contribute to the racial and economic segregation. We wanted greater access and opportunity to attend fully funded magnet programming, that Minneapolis Public Schools will be a district that families will want their children to attend. Students will be excited to attend school, to engage with caring adults, and to challenge them intellectually. And that staff will want to both begin and end their careers at MPS. Our program will be consistent, predictable, and sustainable. Our resources will be aligned to our values. So from academic point of view, as I said before, the foundation of our academic plan is our commitment to offering a well-rounded education to every student in the city. According to the Every Student Succeeds Act, ESSA, a well-rounded education includes the arts, humanities, sciences, social studies, English, and math. Background knowledge in these subjects allows students to transfer the ability to read into other subjects and experiences that require them to make meaning of what they read. Therefore, a content-rich curriculum is not just necessary but for educational attainment, but for comprehension beyond the classroom. When the board approved the strategic plan in 2021, the word holistic was used in this place. But I just wanted to be sure we're all on the same page about what we meant by well-rounded. I'm going to present a snapshot of CDD projects in two categories, completed and ongoing. What I'm going to share publicly is a rather high-level look at these projects, but I want to encourage each of you to see the appendix of this presentation for more details on the level of investment, challenges, and opportunities. You may see the same project included in both categories, ongoing and completed, because we may have completed elements of the project but have additional steps needed. Heading up our completed list is the improvement of our math and literacy education. And by completed, obviously I don't mean that all students are at the levels of academic achievement that we need them to be, but that we have put in place elements of our curriculum, our training, and our instruction that can get us there. Those elements are things you've heard us talk about, like letters training, literacy intervention, and a new math curriculum. We've also done internal work to reduce the focus on the white culture in everything we teach by providing extensive professional development that will help our teachers better acknowledge and incorporate the lived experiences of our students. Again, I want to be clear. Because this is on the complete page does not mean there isn't more work to be done, but that some foundational elements are in place to keep our work moving forward. We were very proud when the board resolved to require students to take ethnic studies as a requirement for graduation as part of the CDD. That requirement will first impact the class of 2025, and we continue to work to expand ethnic studies from a K-12 perspective. With the addition of fifth grade instrumental music, we acknowledge that an understanding and access to music education is a key factor in providing a well-rounded education. So since fall 2021, all fifth grade students have access to instrumental music, and nearly 7,000 students at MPS have received that. We understand that everything MPS students learn in our schools and classrooms must be designed to prepare them for success in college or career. In an effort to give students a jump start on their college education, both academically and financially, all 9-12 schools have one of two options noted here. Either an option to move forward towards graduation through the International Baccalaureate Program, also known as IB, or the other option to participate in the Advanced Placement Program, with additional college credit opportunities through college and schools or concurrent enrollment in post-secondary education. In order to prepare students for success in those high school programs, we are including IB Middle Years program in all our middle schools, excluding our magnets. Hmong and Somali pathways. MPS now offers language and cultural pathways in both Hmong and Somali cultures because part of the CDD required adding programming that acknowledges the unique cultural and linguistic assets of students who attend our schools. While we are reviewing enrollment and academic achievement in these programs, we are also looking forward to increase the Somali pathway through grade 12 and adding Somali language standards. In addition to our STEM and STEAM magnets, through the CDD, all students have access to STEM through additional supplies, professional development, and focus on engineering and computer skills. We are moving now into academic projects of the CDD that are ongoing and not yet complete. As I said, you will see some of the previous projects also on these ongoing slides. Of course, we have more work to do in math and literacy improvement, especially in our work with early literacy for students K through 2. Our work will be to continue implementation of our literacy plan and new math curriculum, and then continue to evaluate the impact of those investments on our students' achievement over time. As we work to help our students see themselves more and more in our curriculum, teachers will continue to receive professional development in how to do that. And the MPS equity competencies will underscore and be aligned with the ways in which we do this work. As we continue to expand college credit programming, we want to ensure that programming prior to high school is aligned to success in receiving college credit. The IB Middle Year program mentioned earlier is one way to do that. But there are ways beginning all the way back to kindergarten to ensure that every student who wants to be is on the road to college success. And to ensure more students receive the science, technology, engineering and math, or STEM, education they need, we must make certain that these are accessible not only to English speakers, but also to multilingual learners. Expanding the new math curriculum to grades 6 through 12 is also an important part of increasing STEM education for all. We now move to the completed projects designed to meet the second of the three goals of the CDD, equity. Research showed that Minneapolis neighborhoods and schools were quite segregated, with the end result that some students, especially our students of color and those qualifying for educational benefits, did not have access to schools and programs that their white middle-class peers had. The CDD required that MPS address these inequities in a number of ways, both in programming as well as our policies. Understanding that mental health supports were needed at every school, all schools are now connected with mental health support specialists who have portfolios across the district. Other mental health supports include the caregiver institutes we've held and will continue to hold that I hope that some of you have participated in. Equity was addressed at a policy level through resolutions to change board policies around enrollment, which has had the bottom line impact of increasing the number of students of color and low-income students who now participate in our magnet programming. Another goal we are working to achieve through updating these policies is a lottery process that supports economic integration that mirrors the district average for economic integration. The next topic is near and dear to my heart as I work closely on ensuring that our special education services were more equitably accessible and available. As a result of the CDD, we worked to make special education services available closer to where students live rather than where space is available in our schools, and we redesigned special education programming at our magnet schools. Fourth, fifth, seventh, and 11th graders were able to continue with their schools and transition through natural pathways, and 90% fewer students are moving to another school since 2017. As a result of the CDD, our magnet schools are becoming more integrated, though we need to do some more research on if we've reached the goals we had hoped for. Since the publication of these slides, we've received updated numbers from the Minnesota Department of Education. Based on the newest data, now only 7 of our 14 magnet schools are racially identifiable schools. And for those of you who are unfamiliar with the terms racially identifiable schools, that means that a school where the percent of protected students is more than 20 percentage points above the percent of protected students in the entire district for the grade levels served by that school. As a result of these changes we made through the CDD, our dual language program's participation has increased, and Fair School of the Arts enrollment has increased 30% since 2020, in no small measure from Principal Cummings' hard work also. In exit interviews back to 2018, families who left MPS widely reported not feeling welcomed or valued in their schools, and that was one reason why they chose a school outside of MPS. Climate is something all of our schools are now more cognizant of, and in fact most and must address through their written goals on their school improvement plans. School community members can receive copies of your school's school improvement plan, and all of those should be posted on each of our school's websites. These are public documents, so I encourage you to see the goals that your school has included. More and more MPS staff are attending professional development around how to improve the climate and culture of their schools and their classrooms so that all students and families feel valued and welcomed. We're very excited about the expansion of our CTE program, which stands for Career and Technical Education. For those who are not aware, CTE is an academic program available to all 9th through 12th grade MPS students interested in earning college credit or receiving job certifications for free. CTE courses emphasize the development of real-world skills and practical knowledge. We look forward to a new CTE center opening at North High School this fall, so that CTE courses will be available at all 3 CTE centers. The 2 others will be located and are located right now at Edison and Roosevelt. Many CTE students now also access 17 CTE courses online. CTE students typically have higher 4-year graduation rates, and higher graduation rates for students of color and indigenous students, so expanding CTE fits well within our CDD equity goals. Students need and deserve high-quality teachers who understand their lived experiences. The CDD underscored the importance of our teacher pathway programs, programs that help staff of color and indigenous staff familiar with MPS find their way into our teaching ranks. A truly exciting part of this work is our impending approval to actually license our very own teachers, pending state approval, a first for a Minnesota school district. We are also continuing to support MPS students interested in teaching through an education program. Because we heard loud and clear the results of an equity and diversity impact assessment that MPS teachers of color need more support, we are providing that through the Anti-Bias, Anti-Racist Staff Development and Support Council, also known as ABARS, and through our PAR mentors. Again, I want to remind you all that while these items are included on the completed project list, there is always more work to be done as we analyze results and assess adjustments for the future. And we move now into ongoing projects aligned with our goal of equity. While we've made headway in some schools around their racial identity, many need work to continue strengthening their magnet-centric curriculum, whether that be STEM, STEAM, arts, global studies, and humanities, or Montessori. We also need to flesh out the K-12 pathways for the magnets and continue our family engagement to encourage more participation in magnet schooling from all demographics. So back to CTE, I mentioned before that students can access CTE classes at North, Roosevelt, and Edison. But building renovations at Edison and Roosevelt have been delayed due to inflationary cost. We also need to implement a transportation plan to get students from their home schools to the CTE centers in North, Edison, and Roosevelt. For after-school programming, we said at the onset of the CDD that every school did not have, but needed, access to after-school programming and transportation. With the advent of the COVID-19 pandemic and the resulting staffing shortages, we are having difficulty staffing, even what we had for after-school programming before. So more planning and funding must be secured to meet this goal, and we'll learn more about this in subsequent board meetings. While having climate goals on a school improvement plans is key to grounding the issue in our systems of our schools, some very basic equity competencies must be established among all school staff, and professional development and experience can help instill that. We're grateful to have the support of the equity and school climate teams, both for professional development and in day-to-day problem solving and support. Social-emotional learning skills continue to be an important tool for both students and staff. And we are moving forward to establishing a formal MPS response process to the incidents of hate and bias. I mentioned the good work that has been accomplished related to the expansion of our teacher licensure pathways, but we'll need more stable funding to ensure that those continue to both operate and expand. And while we're providing more support to teachers of color and have a staff Ombudsman person, sorry, to whom staff can report issues of concern, we still have to work to do to improve the retention of our teachers of color. And that work is very important to myself and our leadership team. So let's move on to our final part of our goal is sustainability. Sustainability is really the need for preserving and strengthening our financial foundation, and this remains critical for us, even as we have shared the projections outlined in our pro forma these past 2 months. MPS has taken steps to change the trajectory of our financial situation so that we remain solvent in the future. I've said publicly that I intend to hand a district over to a new superintendent with a plan for doing so well in hand. The CDD has also instituted some other measures to ensure MPS is here for another 150 years. Leading our completed projects aimed at sustainability are new school attendance areas were implemented in the fall 2021 to help balance enrollment. Our goal in this was to ensure that every school had an adequate number of students so that the funding received could support a well-rounded education. That included working on reducing the enrollment gap between our high schools. This work also included reducing the number of K-8 schools, as MPS found that funding for K-8s did not support providing all the programming that higher grade students needed through that model. I want to acknowledge that the boundaries or attendance area changes was widely recognized to be the CDD. But as I've tried to outline to you tonight, there's much more to this effort. That said, I also want to say out loud that I know the change in attendance areas was very difficult for many families. We understand that, and we still believe that the goals of the CDD made the changes of vital importance for our district. The CDD aimed to improve transportation efficiency through reducing the number of bus routes, as well as reducing walk zones for schools where we wanted to ensure student safety. The bus contractor budget was, in fact, initially reduced by nearly $7 million in regular education routes. MPS also implemented something we called predictable staffing, to ensure that schools receiving funding for key staffing positions that we believe are critical for strong schools. Without predictable staffing, there was some inequity in which staffing positions were available in schools with less discretionary funding. The goal of the transportation efficiency also leads our ongoing sustainability projects, as we need to ensure the boundaries for students receiving special education services meet the other goals of the CDD. Additionally, contractor rates shot up significantly during COVID pandemic, reducing some of our planned savings. While many capital improvements recommended via the CDD have been completed, several are in progress over this next year, including finishing the CTE Center at North, the Bethune Performance Center, which has been the victim of supply chain issues, multiple year capital project improvements for Anderson, and a performance space and science lab for Ella Baker. All right, we did it. That was a lot of information. I hope that you felt my need to be transparent as well as comprehensive as we talked about this tonight. There's also much more information available in the appendix, which I invite you at a later time to make sure that you take a look at that also. So Chair Elamin, I will turn it back over to you for discussion.
Thank you. Thank you, Interim Superintendent Cox and your team. Again, directors, please hit your request to speak button with any questions on the superintendent's report. Director Beachy.
I just had a couple questions about on slide 8. First of all, we talked about the fifth grade instrumental music. I think that's great. But I think what I've been hearing and I saw in some of the other things that are on the slide, that there's a pathway created. Is there a pathway created for what happens after they have their music in fifth grade?
Thank you, Director, for that question. It's something that we went back and forth about, right? Is this a completed or is this an ongoing? And I think we felt like we completed the idea of what fifth grade and that access to that music programming. I think what we have created, though, is this thought about what does that pathway continue to look like for students that we have inspired the love of music in. And Director Fearing, I don't know if you want to speak to kind of what thoughts of your team as you look forward to that.
Absolutely. Hello, everyone. This is my first time addressing you all in different seats. So if I look at a seat and then be like, oh, shoot, over here. Apologies. But thank you, Director Beachy, for the question. Great, great question. We currently have a new music content lead, Mr. Adrian Davis. He was coming from Roosevelt High School, where he did the instrumental music programming there. And he is in process right now proposing a whole MPS music
proposal for myself, and that will eventually be part of our budget conversations. So the short answer, very similar to what Interim Superintendent Cox is, we completed the fifth grade part. We got the instruments, we got the teachers, we got space and student schedules, elementary schedules to do that. But then the next step then is to look at grades 6 through 8 to make sure the students that started have the availability to continue if they'd like, and then also looking at 9-12 because we want to make sure there isn't a stop and start, because as you know with music, you have to keep going, practicing and engaging in that. So that is upcoming and part of our budget conversations.
I did have one other question for you. Just on slide 19, when you were talking about the expanded teacher licensure pathways, I'm just curious what differences between the current process that we have versus what we're going to be able to do with the new authority.
Yeah, it's kind of been a pet project of mine since I left the special education team, but well taken over by our executive director, Hussein, who has carried on the project. You know, our current grow your own pathways provide our current employees the opportunity to continue in their current position whilst taking the classes and doing their student teaching. So for those who have been, there's been often many financial barriers that happen for our staff as they're trying to complete student teaching and take the coursework, as well as it allows us to have a partnership with the university to really focus on beliefs and values that we have here at MPS. Our current application to be an alternative license program would actually allow us to create our own program that's based on MPS, again, our values and mission, but also the skills and the interventions that we use here for our to get a license in special education. The main benefit of that is we can offer the student the courses when we want to. They can still teach while they're here, and we can offer that at any cost we want to, which our ideal would be that would be no cost. So, you know, I was talking to a senior officer, Bennett, who runs that program and oversees that. And, you know, she was saying to me, this could potentially give us 15 to 20 new special education teachers at the end of next year if we would get licensed, which we have no other pathway that would offer that expansive amount of recruitment.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Director Emmerich.
Thanks, Chair Elamine. I have two. The first one is about the format of the presentation. Well, I appreciate sort of having the duality of this is what we've accomplished and this is what's in the hopper. I do think that the completed category is pretty muddy. You know, there are some things in this category that are objectively completed, right? We have an objective measure of, we can cross that off the list. But as Interim Superintendent Cox noted, a number of these items are not completed. They're actually things that are continue to be in the hopper to improve on or build out. And so just a suggestion, if I may, if it's of use, I would love to see this kind of data on the CDD presented as an intent and impact. So I would love to see, this is a specific goal. This is what we want to do. This is what we were hopeful we could accomplish. And here's the range of impacts, along with maybe some information about the rubrics or measures that were used to collect that data. And you know me, I would love to see some really close to the ground, you know, quotes, interviews, conversations at school pickup, you know, those types of data included. I think that it would really be useful to hear the stunning accomplishments, what we're really doing to move the needle in the direction we're trying to go, and also hear maybe some of the unintended impacts that we're getting feedback on that are having a negative impact, even if that's on an individual, family, or neighborhood or site across our stakeholder groups. I think that would let us get a fuller picture of what we're sort of looking at and where we can push forward and where we maybe need to shift. The other, so that wasn't a question, that was some feedback, I hope that's all right. The question that I had is, I'm looking at, I think it's slide 13, special education. When we say more inclusive special education pathways, what do we mean by inclusive?
Dr. Emmerich, I'll start and feel free to chime in, Dr. Fearing. I appreciate your first bit of feedback. I think that's gonna be really important as we move through the next couple months. My goal is that we start to talk about the CDD, but also in terms of the strategic plan. I think it's a lot for our staff to be able to be monitoring two things. So when you talk about the metrics and the impact, I think that we can work on those things as we start to slide that into the strategic plan, which will be what Executive Director Hunter will be doing over the next couple months for us as a board and as a leadership team. So appreciate that. I think when we were talking about inclusive pathways, it was really about increasing what we've called our school-based programming, our SB programs. And that was, we found that our schools really did not have the capacity to provide more intensive services. So they kind of got to a certain level of instructional minutes or ability to carry out adaptations. And then if a student's need required more, they would have to go to a different school for programming, a federal setting three program, we would call it, which would have more intensive services, a more intensive staffing pattern. Through the CDD, we were able to convert some of those classrooms to embed that level of programming in community schools so that a greater number of students would be able to stay in their community school while still receiving that intensive service. It also has the ability to bring a student who might be coming from a more restrictive program and wanting to go back to their community school to provide them the support through that transition also. So that inclusivity was really talking about being able to stay with their general education peers. It also became really valuable when we were looking at our programming at our dual immersions, so that students who could still have the opportunity of that in that magnet programming without having to lose that magnet programming by going to a more restrictive environment.
Can I comment back
yes.
on that? Is that all right, Chair?
Yes, go ahead.
Thank you, Chair. So now I'm not trying to go too hard on anyone, but you know, special education is one of my things. What I'm hearing is that what we're talking about is maybe providing more opportunity for students who might require a federal setting four, which for anyone who doesn't know, that would be a student receiving special education who is in a whole separate building where the students are only students who receive special education to potentially come into a federal setting three placement, which again, for anyone who doesn't know, would be a placement where a student's in there community school or regular Minneapolis public school, but pulled out of general education for 60 to 100% of their day. Both of these are really considered segregated settings. So we don't really have anywhere in the CDD, which is supposed to help integrate our schools, anything about decreasing segregation for our students receiving special education, which is approximately 18%. Of our students in MPS, do I have that right?
Yeah, we're around 17 to 18%. Yeah. So the school-based programming allocations actually do help what you're saying for federal setting three students. So it does give that opportunity for students to stay in their community schools rather than going to another school that they might be assigned to attend a federal setting three. When you talk about federal setting four, we did not address that through the CDD. But the special education department has provided intensive staffing in that federal setting four so that students have the support they need if they're transitioning back to a federal setting three program.
I think it would be great if we could figure out how to better track how we're decreasing segregation of our special education students as part of our plan.
Yeah,
thank you so much.
We can definitely get that data for you. Thanks.
Thanks.
Director Norvell?
I just had a question going back to slide 19 about the pathways to licensure. Interim Superintendent Cox, you mentioned special education teachers, but am I correct in reading that it's all teachers, or is that path to licensure primarily for special education teachers?
So when the Grow Your Own program started, it also did elementary school licensure also, but we found that that wasn't as great of need as we started to see an increase in the number of elementary school teacher licensures and the recruitment and when we did interviewing. So the Grow Your Own program shifted to only special education. The alternate pathway is also specifically for special education. I think the exciting part of it, and I would say both have the ability to grow to other high needs areas as we need it. I would say the exciting thing is we're also seeing teachers who are wanting that special education licensure, who might not have even the desire to work as a special education teacher, but want the skills to know how to do those adaptations, the interventions, and the curriculum adaptations for their students. So I find that really exciting too. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Director Cirillo?
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'm very hopeful, especially for the magnet programs. And when I heard you, Superintendent Cox, saying that this was part of the vision to fully fund the magnet programs. I really hope that we keep true to our word, and that is the case. Something that I can brag about is that at Ella Baker, our seventh graders are gonna be going to Washington, D.C. at zero cost for our families. So that is really, really huge. And for me, the vision is how do we influence and how do we inspire our kids to be the future political leaders that we need to have, individuals with conscience. And the eighth graders will be going to Atlanta. So that is something that is incredible. And I would like to personally thank and acknowledge the work done by Eric Moore. The CDD was really your baby, and this is something that I know that you work really hard. So thank you for your work, the leadership, and everything that you have done and continue to do for the district. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I just can't resist. Thank you for that. I'm so excited about the Ella Baker field trips and that Global Studies and Humanities program. I will say, as we as a leadership team and as we hear your comments tonight, as we look forward to what we need to discuss and bring back to the table to have further discussion about in February, I think magnet schools is one of those pieces. It's fully funding. It's also making sure that the pathways are solid and that we have completed them well. So I look forward to a further discussion about magnet schools and their impact next month. Yeah.
Thank you. Director Jordan.
Thank you, Chair. I just had a couple of quick questions. Now, I seem to recall when we're talking about racially isolated schools, there was two sets. There was the magnets, which we have seen tonight, but we also had a high influx of community schools. And I seem to recall being told that if we had redid the boundaries, CDD was going to integrate these community schools. As of today, how many of those community schools have been racially has any of them been removed from the racially isolated segregated list, racially identifiable? We were supposed to, we're still having those schools, and this was supposed to be something that was told that we were gonna go from, I think, 22 to 23 down to, I think, 6 was the actual number that I recall during one of the community hall meetings. And how long is that gonna take to get to 6?
Yeah, I'll start, and then I know Executive Director Hunter is ready to jump in with the exact data. We did have some, we saw some success, and we saw some increase. So I think the difference in the number, Executive Director Hunter, was one. that we had a difference in. So I asked her to dive a little deeper and to see is how much progress are we making then if we didn't see that exact change in the year and a half that we looked at it. And Executive Director Hunter, could you share a little bit of that data with us?
Yeah, and this, thank you for the question. This is actually sort of hot off the presses because we got new data just this morning. So we were able to process that as a cabinet team. So as Interim Superintendent Cox shared, we're down one school. So we were at 22 racially isolated schools in the 20 to 23 three-year cycle. And now what will be the 23 to 26 cycle, we're at 21 as of checking with MDE this morning. And so some of that reduction, we did have two additional schools added, but we have five schools that have come off. So, and the sort of one key success that Interim Superintendent Cox already shared about is that three of those sites were magnet sites. And that was a really intentional effort of the CDD to place our magnets in schools that were already racially isolated sites in an effort to integrate those programs in a way that didn't force students of color to move elsewhere, right? So placing those in sites where we had high populations of students of color attending. And thus far, that is the largest reduction is in those magnet sites.
Good.
Where I think we need to look at is, to your question, is to what degree are we moving closer to moving off the RIS list for our community schools? And I'd be happy to bring that data to the next board meeting to share with you all.
Yeah, thank you, because I know one of the big draws about integrating our magnet schools, like you had said, was that we would have, of course, greater diversity, and it would also increase our scores across the board, reading, math, literacy, et cetera, so that's good to see it up there.
Director Georgine, could I just interrupt about one other piece of that data, you know, and Senior Officer Moore also reminded us as we've been discussing this week after week after week as we've been looking at the data that it's really important. We didn't actually like clear out all the magnets and say everybody who wants to be part of a magnet come in, right? So we grandfathered families in. So he's really helping us look at the data at kindergarten and also at some of the other grades so that we're looking at that differently, and that will help us understand the trend and make sure that we're also moving in the right direction. So. Sorry about the interruption.
Oh, no, not at all. No, that's great to hear, because I think if we're building on something, even though my opposition to the CDD has been more than public about it, I think even building on some things that are working, and this is one of them. There's a couple other quick little things. Slide 38 shows just a big, brief snapshot of the math and literacy proficiency. I mean, just all students grouped as a whole. And I know maybe for the sake of time, it wasn't brokered down to show individual categories, students by grade, racial background, you know, indigenous, Latino. That usually is a custom. And so I would like at some point to see that. And also slide 51 is kind of the same thing when it comes to college credit programming in regards to our AB, IB, PSEO, CTE programming. Because, you know, it's not just our district, but it's also districts across the country where there's a predominantly large amount of white students that have access to these classes. And I know from my own kids and their friends that there are quite a number of very bright, talented students of color across this district that do not have access to those types of programs in our district for whatever it means. They're either overlooked or they're not thought of. Or what have you, and I don't care what high school that is, whether it's Washburn or Southwest or South, whatever, you know, students of color, you know, they learn just as well as anyone else, and there are so many talented students of color that I would like to see that in the future broken down and aggregated and not just clumped together, because if you look at the numbers clumped together, then it's like, oh, wow, we have all these people taking IB programming or PSEO, but when you break it down by our students' racial background, racial identifiable background, then you're going to see such a wide discrepancy that I mean, everyone in this room knows exists, not just in Minneapolis public schools, but elsewhere as well. And I think I don't have the magic answer for that. I know this is an age-old question that's been going on long before I got on the board, and it's going to be happening probably long after I'm off the board. But I would like to see that in the future segregated down to, or aggregated, whatever the word is, the proper word for it, so to show respective student groups as well. And I'm really kind of curious. I know, I'm sorry, I got two more questions really quick. Slide 54, there's one of the things I've been really vocal about was mental health supports for our students for the last several years, even before the CDI, I've always, that was my background, working with students, families on public assistance, and mental health services has always been something outside of the classroom that affects our students and their parents as well, caregivers. It says on there, under completed, it says one school site declined school link therapeutic services. What, can someone explain to me exactly what that means? Did a school just say we're not gonna take part of this? Or is it something that, I don't know, I'm just kind of curious, I've never seen that before. I'm just kind of curious what that meant by one school site declined school link therapeutic services.
Yep, I can answer that one for you. So first of all, I just want to say thank you. I really appreciate this, like asking us for more deeper dives into data. I think that's really going to help us prepare our presentation for you in February. So thank you for that. We offered through the CDD every school the opportunity to have a community partner that could come in and provide mental health intensive supports, one-to-one therapy for students to take away the barriers of transportation, being out of school, getting to appointments. We did have one school that declined that offer, and instead they asked to just be linked as a partner to another that they could refer their students out to.
Oh,
and
okay.
So we abided by that, know that, understood that our principal knew what was best for his community at that time. We'll always go back and revisit that if they change their mind as a school district.
Oh, well,
school.
Well, yeah, thanks. I was just curious. I've never seen that before, I don't need to know the school or anything. I'm just kind of curious to know how that worked out. And lastly is the school placement. In regards to, unfortunately, you know, the elephant in the room is we do have to consolidate school sites. And one of the things that we are going to have to do, of course, again, is redraw placement boundaries and transportation and walk zones. And one of the things that we really need to tackle on that right now is that while we have great families and staff that came from Modi, sorry. You know, talking about, you know, the supports for the North community, which is sorely needed, and it's great to hear. We need to make sure that those families are supported. And so I think, you know, moving forward, when we're talking about CDD and we're talking investing in community school sites, whether it's North Minneapolis, South Minneapolis, wherever, that people need to know or need to get kind of an idea where their child may be in kindergarten. Because 24-25 is right around the corner. That's two school years. We're halfway through this school year. So we have technically two school years, 23-24, 24-25. And I think it will do a very great disservice to families if we don't start. I know we're working on it now, but I think to have a public discussion so families now who are, say, students and families at I'll get it right. At that very nice school that was here tonight. At that very nice school that I have a general idea of where they can expect their child to go. And I would really hate to see a disservice done to families, especially here that really need it. We have some great programs here in the North Side, so that they're not left in limbo and saying, am I going to be at Munger National or Bethune or whatnot? And we're not going to always in those schools, but you know what I'm saying? There's other kindergarten families across the district that want to know. And leaving them in limbo, I mean, I know this is something that's going to turn around really fast and happen really fast, but I think when we're talking about school placement and the like, I know it was very strenuous and stressful for a lot of families this last time, and I hope that with consolidating school sites that we do take into consideration where we are putting our most needed resources for those families that seriously really need them. Because I'll be honest, my kids are fine where we live, but I've worked in North Minneapolis. My dad used to work right down the street here, and I've served food to families and do all of that stuff. So I know all these resources are needed in this community, and I want to make sure that moving forward, when we're talking about consolidating sites and our placements And to speak to Director Emmerich's points of view, a point of view on special ed that we really do get this right, but leaving families in limbo, I think, would really do a great disservice. You know, and I'm actually one of them because Justine will be in kindergarten here in like 2 years. So I'm kind of nervous myself. So I want to know, you know. But thank you for the presentation and the questions. Thank you.
Thank you. Director Abdi.
Thank you, Director Alamin. I have a question for the CTE. We're going to only consolidate Edison North and Roseville. One of the slides says students who take two CET courses has a 14% higher to graduate in a college. I would like to know how many years that data is collected. Is it this year, or is it going back to the existence? Or, and a student of color who take those two courses has a 44%. I like to break down of those data. And are those courses all over all the citywide? Do the students have option to take concurrent online? Because there's so many offering in online. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if that's really available to every students.
Director Abdi, thanks for the question. We can provide a breakdown of that data after this meeting. What I can tell you is that we do have to collect the data as part of receiving the Perkins grant, which funds a lot of our career and technical ed programming. And then they also send us recommendations back of how we need to move forward if we want to continue receiving that grant money. And two areas in the last evaluation cycle that were cited is that we had to increase the number of participants, our female participants, and then also students of color. But we do collect all that information about graduation rates, attrition rates, concentration, like where are students taking it. They also look to see what the market share is for employability after a student leaves high school. So their recommendations will also include, hey, you're offering a program pathway that's kind of obsolete in terms of the market share for hiring after high school. So we're, you know, recommending that you think about this different pathway that has a lot more openings. So for example, you know, they recommended that we go into more tech, you know, cybersecurity. Those are areas that students can get certificates pretty quickly and get a pretty well-paying job right out of high school. And so that would then, that is then one of the reasons why we moved to solidifying the tech center that we'll see at North. So as far as the disaggregated data that you see here of graduation rates, we can get that to you with the years, the students. We can also pull demographics as well for you on that.
And Director Emmerich, do you have another question?
Yeah, I just had a quick one, more technical. When it comes to our state-required minutes of instruction for our high school students, is that impacted at all by that transportation in the middle of the day to a CTE site? Are those minutes during transportation still considered minutes that meet that standard, or?
Thanks, Director Emmerich. I feel like I should invite you to our student scheduling committee because those are exactly the things that we talk about. So to answer your question, the CTE Center, we have it starting at 8:05. So recently the high schools were, they were approved to start at 8:30. So our CTE Center actually would start at 8:05 to then address that transportation time. We didn't want to play our cards with MDE and hope that they looked at the schedules and saw, oh, there's transportation midday. So that is why we added approximately 30 minutes. But for students, again, you know, coming there, but classes would start at 8:05. Then that would account for that about 30 minutes of transportation during the day with the shuttle, however we play that out. And then, so that way then we wouldn't see loss in transportation time.
Thanks so much.
Yeah, thanks. Thank you. Thank you. I will just ask my questions now. So a couple questions that I do have in regards to the teachers' development and retention. I know we speak very highly of wanting to retain our Black educators, but I'm wondering as far as like our ESPEs, who we know are able to step in the role of teacher at any time. Have we opened up the door to allow them that opportunity to have that training and different development? Because we're looking for teachers of color, and we are looking outside when I think we can start a little more inside
and try to develop what's amongst us right now. So that would be one of my questions. And then just as far as information, when we talked about the high dosage tutoring, if we can just, and maybe if not for this one, for our next meeting, to have more of a breakdown on how that's really working with our special need students, how we identify who uses that service, and what we're actually looking to get out of it. So that's a little more data that I would like to see as we talk about the equity and the academics and where we're going as far as a district.
Chair Alamine, yeah, both of the Grow Your Own programs as well as the alternative licenses is specifically, I would say, geared towards our special education assistants, our other AEs, our other ESPs, because they, before their jobs, they have to have the requirements needed to be in the program. It's a really nice segue to for them. And we have not opened up those either of those programs to anyone outside the district. And it would be open to ESPs as well as other teachers that are looking for additional licenses. As far as the high dosage tutoring, yeah, we were very specific about who got to be a part of that. I don't know if you want, would you rather us just keep that for a slide for next time, or would you like us to go into a little bit about the selection process?
I mean, if we have it.
Yeah, yeah. Absolutely.
Yes, please.
Dr. Fearing.
All right, we're fighting over the microphone. Thank you for the question, Chair Alamine. Sort of initial look at how we were identifying students was based on students who were the farthest from proficiency, so the students who essentially in our eyes we have served the least well. And then we also wanted to look at students who, that was true over multiple assessment periods. So they've been in MPS and we had, I mean, essentially continued to fail to meet their needs. We did eliminate kindergarten students, so that was, I think, a question we had at an earlier board meeting. So we did not include kindergartners in the high dosage tutoring lists as they are new to school, and we want them to be learning in their core classrooms and not in an online tutoring setting. But so again, it was multiple rounds of assessments. I feel like this is from all before break, so I'm trying to refresh my brain. Rochelle, do you want to pop in for a second?
I can talk a little bit about special education services. We know that students who receive special education services are getting very intensive in-person services that would be much better suited for them than this online option. So we only added students who are receiving speech therapy services as students who were in the program, as we knew that based on a student's individual education plan, that's something between a family and or caregivers and the school team to make a decision about. And so we also just are serving the ones with speech therapy services that are needed.
I can give you a quick update. It's right hot off the press this afternoon too, just so to kind of contextualize or give you more number or quantitative. So as of to date, we have 128 total reading groups across the district. We have 143 math groups, and that equals those are groups, so counting student heads now, we have 598 students. We still have open seats to fill, so now we're going through a process, kind of a second selection process. One thing to note that I think is a good thing because we didn't fill all the seats is that our students who are going to receive dual language or bilingual tutoring, they're in groups of one or two, and I think that's actually really good for those students to have a tutor almost one-on-one to work with them. So some of it is, you know, if a student is really benefiting from having such a small group or one-on-one, we'd like to keep it that way because, again, as Executive Director Hunter said on how students were identified, these are the students that were the farthest away or not making yearly growth. So keeping group size very small is actually a good thing. So we're continuing to look at it. We have principals working with the teachers, working with the staff, working with the families, and we're continuing getting updated information, but that's what I got this afternoon with numbers.
Thank you. And just as a even more of a deeper dive, and again, doesn't have to be tonight, if we can have the breakdown by the schools so we can see how that shows up with the individual families. And then just maybe have some of the families that are receiving it to share how this has helped them individually. That would be help as well. My last question would be with the CDD design again, knowing and seeing that Eric is here today, it would be great if he can even just share where he sees it from where it was to where it is now. Again, it doesn't have to be tonight, but I think that would be great information to be shared with us so that we can see where we were and where we're actually going. So that would be my ask.
We will definitely have that prepared. If that's okay with Eric, I see him in the audience. So Senior Officer Moore, that'd be great.
Thank you. So again, thank you. I do believe we have some more slides to be presented from the team, correct? So if we want to allow time for that,
we will, yep.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chair Elamine. Both new and continuing members of the board and interim superintendent, what I can promise you is that it'll be brief, because what I am hoping that you see, and interim superintendent Cox sort of spoke to this, is that so much of the CDD is present in the strategic plan. So that's the sort of beginning of the what I'm going to start sharing tonight is some really intentional connections that we're making between the CDD, which was one of the sort of backbone documents of the strategic plan. So one of the things that we're working on right now, and that you all will be hearing a lot about over the upcoming months, is the budget process. So all departments are asked are expected to align their budgets to the strategic plan. And one of the things that we'll be doing internally is taking a look at then by strategy and goal area, you know, where are there maybe gaps? Where are there places where we need to make sure we don't have duplicity right across funding streams so that we can use our money both in a fiscally responsible manner, but also aligned with our values. And then I've shared this before, but just as a reminder, so then at the school level, each school has a school improvement plan, and those school improvement plans are aligned to the four goal areas of the strategic plan. And then, as I said, the strategic plan was really built on the CDD and the climate framework. So those were sort of the founding documents that were used. And then our leadership team has been working on alignment, so you're hearing some of that tonight, and you'll continue to hear more of the sort of transition to where does this all show up in the strategic plan in the next 2 months. And I did want to give an update. A few months ago, I shared that we have goal groups for each of the four goal areas of the strategic plan that we're meeting weekly from September through December. And I wanna talk a little bit about some high level updates from each of those groups. And each of those groups includes like content leader experts in the areas of the goals, but also members of the associate superintendent team so that we're making sure we're connected to schools. So here's where I need my notes. So you heard a little bit, I was gonna give a nod to high dosage tutoring as one of the things in goal one that we're working really closely on right now. I also wanna share that next month we will be sharing mid-year growth data. So you'll get to see what has happened over the course of this year thus far. Our students are in the midst of taking their mid-year FAST assessments, not tonight, but over this month. And then so I look forward to sharing with you what I hope is a positive picture of growth over the course of this year thus far. The other thing that I wanted to talk a little bit about is that we've talked a lot about PLCs or professional learning communities this year, and I wanted to make some of the support that we're providing more real to both members of the community and to you as the board. So a couple examples of the support we're providing just this week. Each school has one of their teacher leader positions is called a PLC champion. So it's supposed to be the person who's sort of most excited to support this work at the site level. And we provide professional development to those teacher leaders. It's been 3 times thus far this year, and then it'll be another 3 times throughout the second half of the year. And it's all around, one, what are PLCs, what do we want them to look like in schools, but also providing them some sort of peer support across schools. So we created triads of three of these PLC champions across schools to connect with one another between the PD. We give them some a chance to connect about how things are going. And because we know that something that a lot of us don't have enough of is time to connect about the work that we're doing other than just sort of staying in a silo, right? And so we're providing that to, we also invite principals to join if they would like to, right? So that's open to school leaders and then their PLC champions. The other thing that we're doing, just to make sure that principals, as the key instructional leaders in their buildings, also get support around how to support this, like, pretty, like, detailed structure, right? Like making sure that teachers have one time, space, and the materials they need in order to improve achievement, the coaching support that they need if there is an aspect of instruction that they're struggling around. So a lot of that is in collaboration with Amy's team and the K-2 specialists that were funded. But this Thursday, we're providing PD to principals, where we have a panel of principals who have used really sort of creative ways to get PLCs up and running successfully in their schools this year. So that panel will be presenting to the rest of their peers. And then we have breakout sessions for elementary and secondary schools. And then another thing that's a little bit different this year in terms of our support is that we're doing breakouts for our specialty sites specifically because their needs tend to be very different from a large high school or an elementary. So they will also be doing a breakout on how to build PLC structures into specialty sites specifically. Okay. So that's goal one. Goal two, I just want to sort of call out, there's a member of the audience who is a peer of ours. Dr. Megan Hickey is now a member of the cabinet team, and she leads our student support services. And that's a way to pull all of the support that is supposed to be directly supporting students and families in under one leader, and then she has a seat at the table. So those are things like our emergency management services, health, mental health, I had her write this down, counseling, social work, the Family Resource Center, and then retention and recovery of students. So that's a big step forward in terms of the area of goal two. Superintendent Cox already talked about my major update, which was about the MPS Academy. So the work that we're doing to try to get that up and running. The aim is to have the first cohort starting next year. There's a few things that need to get in place before then, but that's our hope to support, again, recruitment and retention of more highly qualified internal staff of color that we want to keep in our system. And then another success related to goal three is that we've actually hired all four of our ABAR positions. So that's a pretty recent, so that's the anti-racist, anti-bias positions that will provide support. And as of, I think it was maybe late last week, all four positions are hired and training is occurring this week for those staff. And then goal four, I think a couple things that Interim Superintendent Cox gave updates on that feel really sort of tangible and important to and are on the like getting ready for completion are the equity competencies. So the goal is to have them complete this year and then embed them into the SOEI or the teacher evaluation rubric. And then the other is the hate and bias incident protocol. So both of those are under the leadership of my peer, Derek Francis. And the hate bias protocol is built into three sections. So the before the incident occurs, when it occurs, and then after the incident in order to support our communities in incidents of hate and bias, I think. And I already said that I will share data with you next month, and I'm really hopeful that we'll be able to dig into some successes and build upon them in the years to come. I'll hand it back to Interim Superintendent Cox and Chair Elamine.
Thank you. Did we have one other slide to share, or was that the final one? Okay, thank you. Director Abdi, did you have a question?
I think you go ahead now, yeah.
No question?
No question.
Okay. Okay. Well, thank you again, Interim Superintendent Cox and your team for their presentation.
for putting together this thorough update to help provide both the board and the community with an understanding of where things are at with the components of the CDD. As we move forward with the development of next year budget and other future planning, this will give us a reference point on key areas of continued focus and those where modifications may be needed. Thank you again. Seeing no, oh, actually there is one question in queue before we close out, which is Director Jourdain.
Thank you, Chair Lamine. I had two really quick questions. One is on the budget. It says all departments are expected to align. Really quick, how does that affect, like, with like inflationary costs? Is that taken into consideration? I know with, like, we had just voted on transportation last month, and some of it was cited for that. Is that going to play into some of our alignments to the budget proposals by department, or not really? Or minimal, I should say.
Thank you, Director Jourdain, Chair Alamein, and members of the board. I would think that yes, inflation, because it is something that is quite wide in its impact. So, because if you take, for instance, salary increase, that's we're increasing salary to meet inflation. So, just in that area, yes, it would impact the departments. When it comes to a department like transportation, we came to the board about a month and a half ago for a budget amendment because of the inflation increase that we've seen coming from our contractors, outside contractors, and we did see increases that were close to 50%, 30-50%. So that would impact the transportation budget, and so we expect that when transportation would come before the panel for budget, that they would be asking for more money to cover for those inflationary costs. And we hope that it is for a time being, and that we'll start seeing it go down. And so, but inflation is all over for us.
Thank you. And then I had one other quick question on the school improvement plans. It says it's aligned to the strategic plan, and I know the process of how they sign off on them. How much autonomy do we give individual sites, like admin and their staff, individual autonomy in developing their school improvement plans? Because they're the ones that are in the classroom on site. They know their students, they know their families, they know their community, instead of having, you know, someone's not as well involved or as well known with their community, deciding what their school improvement plan is. I think, you know, I would rather have someone that's in the building, whether it's a principal or AP or a teacher, you know, have more input.
Thank you for the question, and I agree 100%. So what we do is we provide support from the school improvement team, but they provide support to the principal and their instructional leadership team in digging into their own data at the site level. And then it's every site makes their own site-based decision about what they set their goals in, but they have to be within the four categories of the strategic plan. So as they look at their student achievement and engagement data at the beginning of the year, there might be a particular group of students that they note that they have underserved more, or, you know, have a need to set a goal around for the year, and then it is under their direction to choose the goal.
Okay, so then if we have a site that wants to, say, think out of the box, right? Say try something totally we haven't done before ever, or whatnot, and they come back with their school improvement plan, and somebody higher up says that's not gonna work or that's not gonna fit. How do we go about correcting that to make sure that it does fit, that it does fall under one of those four parameters? Because if you keep doing the same things over and over again, you're gonna keep getting the same results over and over again. And so I think, you know, with such a huge opportunity gap among, or achievement gap, opportunity gap, you know, I think in this day and age, you know, we need to really think outside of the box, so to speak, and make sure that our sites, our individual sites have almost, I don't want to say 100% carte blanche, but, you know, pretty much a really wide open window in terms of what they really want to do to improve their individual sites, instead of someone saying here at the Davis Center, someone elsewhere saying, no, that's not right. We're not going to allow you to do that.
I think one of the things that I would offer is it's there's a balance, right, between providing support based on, say, content leadership, say, on Amy's team, and the knowledge that an individual school leader has of their own community. So I think it's the combination of two of, like, those two. They're like the two parts of the pod, right? And I think, to your point, do we want our schools to think outside the box? Yes, but the sort of the structure to make sure that that school is getting the support they need is that their school improvement team member and then their associate superintendent check in regularly, both on the goal that they set and then the strategy they're using to implement change. And if somebody thought outside the box and it made student achievement change in a significant way, we would want to take a look at why, and then the potential would be to build that out. I will offer that the reason we pull all our school leaders together on a day like this Thursday, so you bring up a good example, where we're having school leaders who have been creative about the way that they've scheduled PLCs speak to their peers, mm-hmm. Because we want that sort of positive practice to build out across the system. Thank you for your question.
Thank you.
Director Beachy?
Just a comment, just to kind of build on that too a little bit. I can agree with Executive Director Hunter had said, we did have a lot of autonomy at Transition Plus to create our own specific strategic plan. And I guess I'm just sort of, with the PLCs, are we allowing that same flexibility for teachers to be able to do their own, or schools or sites to be able to do their own PLC?
It's sort of similar, where we provide the structure that would be, yes, but within the parameters of, we're taking a look at student work, identifying areas where, maybe gaps in either understanding or instructional materials, and then filling those gaps, but yes, based on the needs of an individual group of teachers. Yeah, and that's exactly why this Thursday we have the PLC-specific session for our specialty sites, because that does look a little bit different.
And then finally, just the last real quick question I had about the all four of the positions being hired for the ABAR proposals. Were they hired internally or externally? Or are you not allowed
to
say?
No, I can say it's a combination of both, and it was done in partnership with MFT, so it was a joint interview process.
Director Abdi.
For the high-dose tutoring, why it was only chose for the special education, just speech and not the other ones? What was the rationale behind that?
Yeah, the rationale was that this, if you think about a continuum of support for students, right, from what's happening in core instruction all the way to specialized special education services, we felt like this online tutoring was in between those, and not to take the place of instruction from special education. So we know that our students who receive special educations often need a lot of accommodations, that for many of them, online is not the best. We heard that from many of our parents as we were going through the pandemic. So where we started was there. So that narrow group of students, as we have more space, we can maybe start to open it up. But really, the special education teacher, their specific training, the interventions they have are much more intensive than what this online tutoring would be.
Do we have a mechanism to measure its success then? Like, how do you gauge, like, after this quick spending money, how do you measure that?
Great question. So that's some of the work of my team this spring. We'll be looking at both sort of summative data, so end of year's student achievement scores on either MCA or FAST assessments. We also are, and because we have two vendors, we'll be able to take a look at what the potential impact was for each vendor separately. We will also be able to, or we also intend to get some perception data, so information from the, Director Emmerich mentioned, like, like, how's it going for families, right? Like, what's the experience? And so one of the things we'll be doing is gathering input from students and families who are participating in the tutoring, but we're also gonna want to get a sense of the teacher experience, right? So this should show up. Ideally, teachers with groups of students who are receiving tutoring should see an impact in the classroom. That would be the ideal with this sort of an investment. So my team will be putting together an evaluation plan over the course of the spring that we'll then present to you all once we've completed this chunk of a year of supporting high dosage tutoring.
Thank you.
Thank you again. Seeing no one else in queue, we will move on to the action items. We will first begin with the consent agenda. The consent agenda includes routine items that do not involve major policy, budget or taxing decision, bond awards, or items related to the superintendent's contract or evaluation. Director Abdi, will you please move approval on these items, remembering that it includes the item as posted, except for the Axiom contract authorization, which we will take up just after this vote.
Approved.
Is there a second? Second. Approval of the consent agenda has been moved and second. Is there any discussion? Seeing no further discussion, all those in favor say aye.
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 All those opposed say nay. That motion carries and the consent agenda is approved. Next, I'll move the contract authorization with Axiom. Is there a second?
Second.
It has been moved and second to approve the contract authorization with Axiom. As I move to have this item pulled from the contract agenda, I will ask Interim Superintendent Cock if she can have someone from her team to speak to this contract to provide us with more information as it was added late to the agenda.
Yeah, we apologize to the board for the lateness of this contract, and Dr. Fearon would be happy to share some more information about it.
Hi, thank you, Chair Alamine, and I will also apologize for the late addition. Still trying to get a cadence, but I do want to go over just a few main points, and then obviously I'm here to answer any questions. So the first point is that our ACT, we offer ACT for our students. We call ACT for all, meaning we're a district that offers ACT free of charge for all of our students at least once to take the exam. That's not always true in other school districts. We have a separate contract with ACT to be able to do that. So we have our own date just for Minneapolis Public Schools, just for our students, so that our principals can schedule around it and give all of our students that opportunity to take it if they so choose. With that date being set April 25th, one of the things that we heard from our students, and I was particularly at Henry, actually, we were talking to the Education Pathway students, and we offered up a question about what is it that you need, right? And these are mostly 11th and 12th graders, I believe. And resoundingly, they said, we want more practice with the ACT. So of course, I put that in my mind, like, okay, let's go figure this out. And then when you look at the timeline of, you know, making sure we're doing our due diligence of finding a good online curriculum, et cetera, that's kind of why the timeline got pushed so close to today. The other thing I'd like to state, apparently last time I talked about high dosage tutoring, I had a gleam in my eye, so hopefully it's still there and the passion's still there, but district-wide, we have an average score of 21 on the ACT. And some of our subgroups are as low as 16 average score on the ACT. So when I see that and when I hear students asking for that support, I have to move on that. I don't have a full year to go into very in-depth investigations, et cetera, but I need to find a solution and an access point for our students this year. Now we can always revise and change it up as we head into next year, but I did hear the urgency from the students. I've also heard from citywide as well, is that something really quickly for high school that we could put into place, and they would definitely appreciate it. The contract with Axiom, this is what it would provide, just to give a little bit more information. They will provide site licenses to our high schools to provide unlimited access asynchronously for any high school student in that high school.
meaning a student can sit at home on a Saturday, or if they go to a tutoring center, they can have someone sit there and work it through with them. But they have that access, and we wanted to make sure we had that in place, because not every student can stay after school. Not every student can register or find places in their schedule during the day to take an ACT prep class. So that's one piece of what the contract here would pay for, is site licenses, so that, for example, Washburn could say to students, here's a site license, all you have to do is put in your information, you can go ahead and practice on your own, practice with a parent, a neighbor, an older sibling. The other part of the contract actually supports in-person tutoring for the ACT as well. So if a school does have a class with a teacher assigned, which back in my experience we had at Wellstone, and then the teacher who taught it had to do some quick learning on what's on the ACT to teach the class, that classroom will maintain the teacher that's assigned, but will also then have an in-person tutor to help the students work through that online curriculum as an in-person support. We're also offering an after-school option for students to work through this curriculum, but with a tutor, if they would so choose. So that's what this contract covers so far. Before I went with this contract, I did have a community member and our content specialist in math, science, English, and our college credit programming take a look and go through the practice ACT online curriculum. Because the last thing I want to do is bring a curriculum to high school students that is not aligned to our Minneapolis values, and then we'd be back having another conversation about this in a month. So I did want to do my due diligence, which took a little time, of course, because they went through and they checked the questions, they looked at it, we found a few errors, but we addressed that with the vendor to say, hey, I mean, we're thinking this answer isn't correct. The other piece, too, that I was looking for in this ACT prep kind of online curriculum, that is if a student was going through it by themselves, that they would also have some learning on test-taking strategies, right? Because it's sometimes about the content, but it's sometimes about that stereotype threat, that test anxiety for a high-stakes test like ACT. So one thing that's nice in this online curriculum is they go through a lot of that test anxiety about how to center yourself, breathing, you know, I can do this, I have to remember the content that I know I have. And so you don't find that a lot in ACT prep curriculum, you just find sample questions, right? But this actually takes them through like little videos about how to get themselves ready for the test. So I thought that was a nice addition to having that, especially if a student is working through it on their own. And I'm just seeing if there's anything else here. I think I'll open up to questions because maybe there's more questions other than what I've presented about this particular contract.
Thank you, Dr. Fearing. Director Beachy?
So during the synchronous part of this, how many teachers do we have for this program, and how many schools are we offering it to? I guess those are the first two that I have.
Yeah, good question. So we sent out a notice to all of our high schools and specialty sites to say, hey, are you interested? So right now we're collecting that information back. Some of our schools already have like an ACT prep class scheduled for quarter three, which is great, because then we could just move it right in. Some are talking to their schedulers to see now if they can actually schedule a class during the day now that they know they'll have an online curriculum and someone there to support the teacher. So I don't have any firm numbers. All I know is that schools, the principals that I spoke to, high school principals, were really excited to have this support because their students have been asking for this as well.
So all of our high schools will have our goal is to at least give them that opportunity,
yes,
to be able to
so
do this.
So we're offering it to all, but I'm not quite sure.
Sure. And then I guess finally, you mentioned that for a school year, you're talking about the rest of this school year, or you're talking about a calendar year?
No, this contract would go to June 30th.
Okay.
But what we'd want to do is if it was an in-person class type of situation, it'd be a quarter three class. Okay. So that ends, I think, March 30th is the last day. Then we go into spring break, and then they'll take the test within 15 days after spring break. So this is just to see, right? Again, because I want to be able to have time to collect feedback from students, for sure. Because if students say, oh, this is just horrible, it's not working, it didn't help me, I mean, no, there's no reason to continue that. The idea we can continue, but there's no reason to continue with that vendor, with that online curriculum.
Thank you.
Yes, you're welcome.
Director Emmerich?
Thanks. One question, one comment. Just to clarify, when you say offered as well to specialty sites, do you mean contract alternative learning programs? Is that rolled in or is that separate?
They could use it as well.
Okay, and then what about Stadium View?
They could use it as well.
Okay,
for
cool.
sure, since it's a an online program, they could have one of their staff members, and or if we were to have a tutor that would go in, they'd have to go through the process.
Okay, so the opportunity at least is available. Okay,
absolutely.
And thanks for that. And then my other comment is a thanks, actually. I just wanted to thank you so much for mentioning that you'd gotten feedback from Citywide on this very student-centered idea, and I want other directors and senior officers in the room to know that I love that, and don't be surprised if I sometimes ask you in your presentations, have you run this by Citywide, what'd they say? So that might be a good thing to preemptively take the opportunity to do whenever you can. Thanks so much, Dr. Fearing, for that.
Thank you.
Thank you. So I have a couple questions in regards to this contract. One is this is not a new contract. Is this a returning contract or is it a new?
It's new.
It is new.
Mm-hmm.
So we don't have any type of data or anything that we can refer back to see.
No. But I will add, Chair El-Amin, that I forgot to add this before, but part of the contract actually is for them to do pre and post reports of student results as well. So that we'll have that data as well. And then our REA department will be collecting that. But in the past, you know, schools had the option to offer maybe a class. Some schools bought their own curriculum, ACT prep curriculum. But again, leaving that to the whim of budget and to student voice, like if they've said they want it, but somebody else didn't at a different school, I wanted to be able to level the playing field in terms of access and opportunity. Again, it's going to be up to the high schools to choose if this is for them. But yeah, so we have not done this before, as long as I've been in this position.
When we chose this vendor, how was that choice made? Did we have other vendors that we looked at to weigh our options? How was this one selected?
No, as part of the, so thanks for the question. As part of the high dosage tutoring, when we heard the vendor presentations, this vendor actually presented their ACT prep as an additional offering or option. At the time, we were very focused on K-8, so I kind of shelved that in the back of my mind and said, okay, maybe we'll get to that. But again, I wanted to make sure that we had solidified the K-8 with the high dosage tutoring. After I heard from students at Henry and then other places too about this would be a really quick win for them and something that they're asking for, I brought that back to the front of my mind. I'm like, oh yes, this would also fit under that high dosage tutoring because many of our students lost out during the pandemic of having some the opportunity to gain the skills either in test taking and or in the content areas need for ACT. And it's not something that you can just, I think for most students, just go pick up a book and study. I think for a lot of our students, they need to be kind of led through the process. It's very intentional test. It is really looking at core academic skills, the ability to transfer knowledge, and the ability to take a test, right? So there is college readiness throughout the exam, but I would say for many of the students I talk to, they like to have guidance through that, not just go check out a big ACT book and say, here, read through this at night, you know? So I think going through and listening then back to the presentations by this one vendor, I still wanted to do homework on what they had, so of course they sent a sample, the sample curriculum, had some, you know, conversations about what schools they've used this in before, et cetera. But, so that's how I landed on it, is that it was actually part of their high dosage tutoring presentation for K-12, but we were really looking at K-8 at the time.
So what is our goal on how many students we hope to use the service? And then how are we gonna let families know
sure.
that this is available?
I mean, my goals are quite lofty, so I mean, take it as it is, but I would hope any student that's going to take the ACT, which again is coming up here in April, at least have the opportunity to go through some of the questions and just get a sense of how well they are doing so that they can then have that conversation either with their teacher, administration, support staff about, man, I think I need a lot more support in this before I go in and take this test, or be like, you know, I think I did okay. I think maybe just a little brush up, you know, a few days before will be great. But I think one of the things that our high school students, we don't provide on a regular basis is an idea of what's coming up next. So it'd be great for a teacher to say, here are five sample questions. I want you to go through them. Now, where, what are you thinking? How are you feeling, right? If you're getting 0 out of 5, you know, here's an online program that you could go through. It'll help you with gaining some of that knowledge and test-taking skills. So my, to answer your question, I'd hope every student that's going to take the ACT has some type of connection to it. I won't be able to force any student, obviously, to go through it, but the opportunity would be there. The outcome of this, I think it's both quantitative and qualitative. We do know that if a student has the ability and access to be more prepared, they will do better. And I think not just content, but also that test-taking strategies, that stereotype threat, that test anxiety, working through that before they actually sit down to the assessment. Many of our students, I'll just put it this way, may not know it's ACT day tomorrow. All of a sudden they walk into school with their back, they're like, I have to take the ACT today? And it's like this whole, like, whoa, you know? And so I want to prevent that as much as possible to get them prepared for that test. So my hope is that in quantitative wise, we'll see higher scores, higher composite scores, but also high sub scores in English, math, and science. For qualitative, I think it goes back to the student experience and what are teachers saying, what are parents feeling, how are students finding the use of an online program? Is it something we want to replicate and expand and scale up, or is it something that maybe next year we can just give site licenses and they do on their own, we don't have to offer in-person support? So it's both quantitative and qualitative for me at this point.
So when my son was in high school, three years ago, the school counselor help walk and guide him through this information. Mm-hmm. Is that not a service that the counselors provide anymore, or?
Yeah, I mean, that's a good question. I think it's very independent to the site. If they have a class where they assign students up, again, it's an elective course, so it's gonna be contingent on time in the schedule, contingent on interest if a student feels like he or she needs it. I would hope that counselors would be having that conversation with students about, you know, here's one of the assessments that you'll be taking. You need to take it. This is what it means. Here's a website where you can take some free sample questions, see how you are. But we also know that that conversation probably isn't happening with every student as much as we would like it to. So I think this also promotes that conversation, but also gives the tangible access to then do something about it. If the student's like, oh yeah, I want some extra help. Okay, great, here's XYZ for you, versus like, oh, well, I think here's something here that might help you. So, but a counselor probably is not walking through an entire test prep with students.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
Director Norville.
Thank you. You mentioned, Dr. Fearing, you mentioned that schools have an option to opt out. If that happens and they opt out, will we have some sort of license that can be provided for students at that site? Because as you mentioned, if it doesn't fit in their schedule, if that ACT prep is an after school class through community ed, which it's been at some sites before,
mm-hmm. Yes.
Will we have something like that? And how will that be communicated to families of those students?
Yes, that's a good question. And unfortunately, I can't give a solid answer to that because the way it was priced for this contract that is up for your approval is by site license, not by student license. Now, if we have a school that's like, I don't think that's for us, or the majority of our students may not use it, but there's a group of students that are like, we'd like to use it, we can definitely enter into more conversation with the vendor, and I'll probably come back to all of you for an amendment, right? So I think that it's not that I'd ever look at a student and be like, absolutely not. We would find a way to make it work for the student, but it might take some of your help at the end of the day if we have a lot of students that would like that, and we have to increase the contract. Yep.
If I might, I'd just like to end the conversation discussion of saying we have really tried this year to put in a lot of long-term planning to look at the achievement of our students. And you will also see this team trying to think of some short-term boost, we've been calling them, to really make a difference now for families now so they can see it. We know some of these long-term things we're putting in place, curriculum adoptions, interventions are gonna take multiple years to really see the impact of those. And it's gonna be very important for us to hold steady on those so we can see the impact. But it is also critically important for our families to feel like we are in the here and now and really want to be a partner with them in some of these highly critical moments of learning to read, of the ACT test, those kind of things. So I just appreciate the team stepping out and going the extra mile to really try to think of some creative ways that we can continue and make impact this year in a short-term process too.
Thank you. Is there any other discussion on the contract authorization with Axum? Seeing no further discussion, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed say nay. That motion carries and the contract authorization with Axum is approved. Thank you. The next item, the repeal of policy 7420 on bonded indebtedness, labeled as Resolution 2023-001. This item would repeal a policy that is redundant to both state law and other existing MPS policies. It was recommended by the Policy Committee and had a first reading last month. Director Norville, can I please get a motion to approve this policy?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Resolution 2023-001, repealing policy 7420, has been moved and second. Is there any discussion? Seeing no or no further discussion, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed say nay. That motion carries and the policy repeal is approved. Next, we will have the reports and comments from Board of Education directors. Our final item this evening is time for directors to give a brief update on the committees they chair or any other board-related activities. I recognize we just set the committees lined up last week, so I understand if we do not have any or many reports quite ready yet tonight. Directors, if you have comments, please hit your request to speak button and I'll run through the list. Director Norville.
Thank you, Chair. The Policy Committee will hold its first meeting of the year on Tuesday, January 24th at 4:30 p.m., just prior to the Committee of the Whole meeting. We will meet right here in the boardroom.
Thank you. Director Ellison.
Yes, thank you, Chair Lamine. I just want to mention, I just have a couple comments. If you are a community and still listening, then you likely know that our listening sessions are about to begin. As early as this Thursday will be our first one. We will have 6 listening sessions throughout this month. I just ask that you share with your contacts, let folks know that we are listening. This is the first step to setting up a profile for our next superintendent. And also, I sit on the Phillips Indian Educators Committee. I missed their last meeting. There's a meeting this Friday, but I want board directors to be aware of the gathering that is taking place on January 31st. It is the requirement in the memorandum of agreement with the Native American community that board directors will sit down, dinner, and meeting with the community. And that is, so check your calendar, it is January 31st. So that's all. Thank you.
Thank you. Director Jourdain.
Oh, thank you, Chair Lamine. Just really quickly, with the community listening sessions, just a reminder, if there's a time and date that does not work for you, you can go somewhere else. You do not have to go out to the community session that's nearest your house. So if you live over Northeast and the Northeast times don't work for you, by all means, hop in your car and go to Washburn or Urban Ventures or someplace else. So don't feel like if you miss it in your area, you can go anywhere else. I will be at most of them.
Yes.
I will be at Munger International and North High because I think going out and hearing other voices other than the ones that where you live and where you represent and stuff like that, I think is really important, especially in this day and age. Being a superintendent. And so lastly, I just want to say welcome to everybody that's new and returning to this board. It's going to be a great time. I think we have a really good crew of folks and looking forward to getting some good productive work with my coworkers. So welcome.
Thank you.
Finally, I'd like to provide an update on our superintendent search work. As we enter this month of community engagement with both an online survey that is open until January 23rd and community listening sessions happening throughout the city. Beginning this Thursday with the session at Hmong International Academy at 6 p.m. NPS staff and families can check their texts and emails for a link for the dates and location, and we ask that everyone listening help spread the word to the broader community about these important opportunities to share with your perspective. All session dates and locations and the survey link can be found on our website. But if you are not able to participate in either of these ways, or even if you are, I encourage you to reach out to your board member and let us know your thoughts directly. Every one of us is eager to hear from many people as possible during this process. We now have a tool on our website where you can enter your address and get contact information for both your district representative and the at-large members. Please feel free to contact any of us by phone or email. For information about the search, the survey, the listening session dates and location, and more, visit the superintendent search website, which is at board.mpls.k12.mn.search/soup search. That again is board.mpls.k12.mn.us/soup search. Well, that concludes our agenda. Our next meeting will be a special meeting to interview and select an executive search firm for the superintendent search next Tuesday, January 17th at 6 p.m. Without objection, I will now adjourn this meeting. I gotta remember. Good night, everyone.